White Stripes. Where am I? Okay, White Stripes and Icky Thump. There you go. That's how we start. Good morning, everybody. We're just chit-chatting. We chit-chat as the song is playing.
Henning it up, we call it.
Yeah, exactly. There you go. What's up, Jim Florentine?
What's going on?
Just trying to settle in. I mean, that song just faded out. It surprised all of us. I wanted to listen to it, too, because I like White Stripes. You like the White Stripes?
Not bad.
Not bad? All right.
And all right.
Yeah. What's up, Jimmy?
Hello. Tired today.
You're tired?
I went to bed at a decent hour, too.
You're
I've been very good lately, yeah. But, you know, I'm getting older. I don't have the energy I used to have as a younger boy. It was fun last night.
I heard it was a great time.
Awesome. Bill just didn't feel like doing it. No. Fucking Bill. I think Bill was very upset. He was having trouble getting out of L.A. He was...
You're talking about the Patrice O'Neill benefit,
yeah.
And Bill Burr couldn't make it out of L.A.
He tried. Maureen, I walked in, that's the first thing Maureen said. She's like, he's so out of his mind. Fucking...
I can imagine. This means a lot to him. He sets up the whole fucking thing every year.
Yeah.
But then Louis C.K. stepped up.
Yeah, Louis filled in, and we knew before, like, we first got there, she said, don't ask us all not to announce it, because the show, I got there, like, around right before 8, and the show starts, like... And she said, Lou won't be here at 9:30. So they wanted to make sure he was going to come, and it wasn't, you know, who knows? You never know.
Yeah.
So they had us all stretch a little bit and do a little extra time and just to make sure. And he did come. So
who was the lineup this year? Voss MC?
Voss was the host.
Yeah.
Godfrey destroyed up front.
Yeah.
Rachel Feinstein was. Everyone did great.
Right.
Rachel Feinstein.
Artie Lang.
David Tell. Myself, a guy, Al Del Benny, was in Casinos, Patrice, from way back
sure.
when. And, oh, God.
Is that Greer Barnes
Greer
up there?
Barnes,
Greer,
yes.
Greer's great.
Greer Barnes, I forgot.
I think you got just about every. Oh, and Russ Meneve.
And Russ. Russ was great, yes. And
old Russ Meneve.
And then
Russ.
Louis did really well. Really funny. I haven't watched him do stand-up in so long. It was very entertaining.
That's awesome. I heard it was a huge success once
yeah.
again, so very, very cool.
Yeah.
Very cool.
He's a funny fuck, man.
Was Voss nervous emceeing?
He was okay. He was,
he's always gets nervous because he's like, I did it last year.
No.
Yeah,
it
was just so funny.
I didn't do these jokes. Are they going to know if I do the same joke? Fuck them. I'm doing the same jokes. And then he doesn't do any of the jokes and he kills every time.
Yeah, he does great. But leading up to it, he's a panicky Pete, as you would like to say, Jim Florentine.
He had a very funny line about where he made it like he was going to bring you an aunt out. And he's like,
I heard.
I couldn't have done this. You know, I didn't see the line. He told me before he did it. And then I heard it kind of. He's like, you know, I couldn't have done this alone. It's just these two guys. It was a lot of negotiation to get them together. And people started cheering. He goes, did you really think they were coming out? And I'm paraphrasing by what Dummy told me after the show. But
he was all excited about his little bit.
Yeah.
Good for you, Rich. Your cute little bit.
What, he texted you?
Yeah.
He told you he was doing it.
Well, he told everybody.
Did he check it with you if it was okay?
And then he had to call Bonnie, or Bonnie called him, because, you know, Bonnie was on the radio last night, and she was all excited. How'd it go? How did your bit go? I heard it got a great reaction, so fucking Voss is a dick. God, I can't believe that Bill Burr thing. That sucks, but it's great that Louis stepped up.
Yeah, Louis, you know, I guess I don't know if Bill called him. I'm going to guess it was Bill
yeah.
who called him and said, look, this is the deal.
Right.
So he did it.
Nice.
That was a big thing.
Yeah, of course.
That translates. Getting Louis for, and he did like a half hour of 35 minutes. Getting Louis for a half hour, that translates into a lot of bucks.
A lot of buckaroos.
Yeah, even though the tickets were pre-bought. But again, people were still bummed about Bill. It's like, nobody was like, oh, fuck Bill, Louis here. They were like, ah, it sucks. Well, all right, well, at least we have a great comedian replacing, you know.
Yeah.
But people still miss Bill. And I missed him. I was really looking forward to seeing him. So I was very bummed that he wasn't there.
Well, I was going
to
go see...
But he didn't feel like doing it. You know, it was so weird. I was talking to him, and I'm like, I'm looking forward to...
You don't think he didn't want to follow you? Is that what it was?
No, he just didn't feel like making the trip.
Right.
I texted him. I'm like, I can't wait for the Patrice benefit. And he wrote back, meh. I'm like, wow, that was kind of a shocking
but
surprise.
Billy, you set this whole thing up.
He said, yeah, but, you know, I did at one point, and then he wrote, like, that was then. This is now. LOL. I'm like, all right.
Everyone should just get over it at this
point.
Yeah,
exactly.
I think it's what he was quoted saying.
Move on.
Move
yeah.
on with your lives.
But
good point.
What's that?
Someone has a good point about Bill Burr.
What?
I don't want to get anybody in trouble, but he has a helicopter license.
Oh.
He could have flown himself in.
Yeah, yeah, he could have flown a helicopter from L.A. to New York.
Yeah.
How many hours would that have taken? How many days?
Yeah, he could have left last Tuesday and gotten there.
Exactly.
But they said he had a gig at the Paramount that he canceled because he couldn't fly in. So that my flight was canceled Friday leaving, so I know his was probably canceled coming in. And they said he tried to fly in all weekend, and he couldn't.
Yeah, no, there's people been stuck for like 2 or 3 days.
Yeah,
that's all over the country getting back in.
That's a big gig to cancel out there in Huntington at the Paramount, too.
Yeah.
So I was going to try to go to that one.
I don't know who does his travel. I mean,
yeah, maybe he.
I got in from Phoenix.
Yes, you did.
But you got to make connections and stuff like that. He might just be calling the airline and sitting on hold for 2 hours. You know, if you're doing airline stuff like a regular comic does airline stuff, I hope Bill's got somebody. I don't know if he has an assistant or not.
Yeah.
But like, you know, the website, I'm bad with that stuff. Like, thank God Kenny and my manager are really good at that. Like, when this crunch time came, those guys saved me.
Sure.
You know, Bill might be doing it himself and just be a typical comic. Yeah.
But I was surprised you made it back to New York, Jimmy, with the blizzard that hit us.
I was surprised I made it back when I did. I knew I'd get back eventually. I said, I'm not going to live here. I had to get back for a fucking... I had to be in Brooklyn by 6 Monday, so I'm shocked I made it.
Yeah, I didn't think you were going to make it back Sunday. I thought you maybe would get back... Yeah, whatever.
I was happy I did, though. Because,
talk about this a little longer.
I wanted to do a little acting on Monday morning, and I had to get back in time for that.
The fucking snow is melting fast. It's like 45 degrees out there.
It's great.
It's great, right?
I got back Sunday morning from... I was up in Albany. Albany got no snow, which is the weirdest thing ever.
Because they usually get hammered.
Yeah. They didn't get nothing. So one of my neighbors or somebody plowed my driveway for me. I still don't know who.
That's nice.
Yeah, because I came back. I'm going to be under 2.5 feet of snow shoveling on Sunday, and it was completely
clean. And your driveway was all nice for
you? Unbelievable.
Wow. You're a good neighbor. Someone likes you.
I still don't know who did it.
Francesa. Mike Francesa.
Yeah. Just finding driveways to clear with a snowblower.
That was nice. I guarantee you, one of your neighbors got a new snowblower, and they were enjoying it, and they were done with their shit.
Yeah.
And they're like, this is kind of fun.
That's what I hear. You get a snowblower, and you want to just snowblow everything. Every fucking thing.
You know, like, this Jim Florentine's a fairly good guy. Why not?
Mm. Yeah, my old neighbor used to do it. They lived next door. I'd see him out there with the snowblower. I didn't want to go out and start shoveling because I'm like, let him keep going because then he's going to go, all right, he's got it.
Yeah.
And then he would do the whole driveway, too.
It'd be great if the guy comes over, like, you know, knock at your door in a few days, and the guy's like, hey, I just plowed your driveway. You're like, oh, man, thanks, come in. And then you turn around and his cock is out.
I might just give him a hand job and don't look him in the
hand
eye.
Hand job? Not for a snowblow.
Yeah, you're going to have to go all the way.
No, I won't go all the way, but I mean,
you have to. It's a blizzard.
Be more snow?
No, because he didn't do the walkway. I'm not going to blow him.
But it's a blizzard.
You know what I mean? He didn't do the walkway, and I still had to do that.
Think right, about you driving up 2.5 fucking feet of snow in your driveway. I think you got to blow the guy.
My driveway's not that big to blow him. It's not.
What if it was one of those long driveways, one of those long winding driveways?
I take it in the face.
You'd have to just take a few splashes.
Yeah, I put some ski goggles on.
Oh, wow. All right. I woke up fucking sick. I want to thank Paul and Roland and your stupid roommate, Larry.
Yeah.
Larry!
Come on, Paul.
How's your stomach?
Am I gonna get sick, Paul?
Absolutely fine.
Okay,
I'm
it was like a 24-hour bug.
Yeah,
okay. I feel like I'm on the border. I woke up with just snot like pouring out of my nose onto my pillow.
Sniffles. I didn't have the sniffles.
What did you have? Sniffles, you little devil!
No, I didn't have the sniffles.
What did you have?
Just a stomach bug. Just like felt like I got kicked in the gut.
He was puking on Monday at the end of the show. I thought he was looking for attention because people around here look for attention at times. So I started laughing like, oh, look, Paul needs attention. And then we went over there and he's fucking power booting into that garbage pail at the end of the show. And then he decides to stand next to Eric Stango.
He plops down right next to Eric.
Then he decides to walk over here.
But Eric, you're okay. Justin, you're okay.
Yeah,
all good.
So far, we're
all right. Mars is out today.
Mars is out.
Why?
And I feel just
sick. He caught something.
But
Mars wasn't here on Monday, so he didn't get it from
me. Yeah, but he could have got it before.
Yeah.
You might have had it. You could spread it before even puking.
Right. Yeah, so I don't know.
My son had a stomach flu last Christmas. and we got the whole family together. There was like 25 people there. He got 14 people sick.
Nice.
14 people within 8 hours were puking everywhere.
Nice.
14 of them.
He wiped out 14.
14.
He's a fucking patient zero.
That fucking rule.
I know. It was great. I didn't get it, but yeah, I just warned everybody. I go, look, he had a stomach flu. I think he's over. I just want to let you know. Yeah. Okay. And he just, next thing you know.
In my family, we all have young kids, so they're all coming home with something all the fucking time.
Yeah.
So there's always somebody sick. But you have a kid that took out 14.
14. It's beautiful.
You didn't
get me.
Huh?
And you
didn't get me,
you
know.
But I think your immune system just gets stronger because I'm not getting sick left and right with these kids coming home sick. I got two different schools, too. So each school has at least a few kids every single day with something.
Oh,
then,
I know.
Then my son's bringing that shit home, and so far, in general, we're okay, I guess.
Yeah, we are Harry healthy now with your green drinks.
I'm trying. No green drink today.
What is that?
This is emergency.
I hate emergency. It makes your
I'm
mouth
trying everything.
Like ass, right?
Yeah, but I'm trying to stay ahead of this.
Like
fucking
your
thing.
Like your mouth's never tastes like ass. I'm before.
I probably should have come up with a better example. Yeah, because that would be a fucking. That's a delightful memory.
I'm going with the vitamin C, super orange, and then I'm going to try some of that Coldies. I'm going to try to stay ahead of this shit.
Right, but the person who handed you that packet was infected.
Yeah,
so
I know.
You're screwed,
Paul.
I know.
And then I'm going to go to my juice store and get one of those fucking things with the cayenne pepper, ginger
it's apple.
Like, it's like a warm drink. It's,
yeah, no, that's a good one.
It's horrible
to
tasting.
Knock it out.
What is it? What is that one called? Ah, the Cold Warrior.
It's spicy, yeah, but you know, when you drink nasty shots in bars, you've done it over the year where it tasted bad and you just,
yeah,
you drank it down.
Sure.
That's what you got to look at it like with these drinks.
Well, a lot of times I would just dump it while the other person was drinking theirs. Like, you know the deal.
Oh, yeah.
After a while,
still
you're like, enough
it.
Already. You
yeah.
do?
Yeah.
Or you whisper, give me a fucking water, please.
Yeah.
And then you get a water, they get the tequila.
Especially if a chick hands you a shot. Like, you know.
You want, maybe.
You're
sure.
trying to close the deal. You can't go, nah, I'm all right. You know, you don't have to drive. Your hotel's right across the street. Yeah, I know. All right.
Yeah.
And then they're not looking.
You just throw it over your shoulder.
Yeah.
Dump it on the floor.
Yeah.
The quick dump on the floor.
And then you stand in it so she doesn't know that it's wet.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Like a gentleman.
Yeah. Well, you don't want her to know that you threw it on the floor. If you throw it on the floor and she's like, you waste that shot.
I'm done with shots.
Sometimes it's good if you want to catch up to people. You want to get a nice little a buzz, a beer and a couple shots. Hmm. You'll catch up with people that were drinking for the last 2 hours. If you come into a party and you feel like, you know.
I'm done with shots.
I don't mind them.
I'm done. I kind of like those edibles. I don't even really like alcohol that much. A couple of beers every once in a while, but I'm done with shots.
Yeah.
Oh, God, I'm too fucking old. The hangovers suck. It's not worth it anymore.
If you're going to do three or four, yeah, but if you do one.
I guess one, if it's a fun shot.
I got a Jaeger.
It's a pussy shot.
I got a Jaegermeister tap machine.
Do you really?
Yeah.
A what?
Jaegermeister.
Remember the Jaegermeister machine,
do,
Jim
yeah.
Norton?
Yeah.
You have one at home?
Yeah, I got one in my basement, yeah.
Wow, that's evil.
How do you not abuse it?
I don't even use it. You know.
Is there anything in it?
Yeah. It's all ready to go. I get the chill. Yeah.
We used to have one until, you know, there was a girl, you know, completely naked crying on the sidewalk after one of our radio shows.
That's right.
And then Jimmy's like, maybe we should get rid of the Jaegermeister machine.
Yeah, true.
Really?
I fucked a friend in what would eventually become Ron and Fez's office over at XM.
You did?
Oh, boy, did I. No bag, no nothing. You know, Ron and Fez. Yeah, eventually once Ron and Fez came over to XM, that was their office.
And then a famous comedian might have had his thumb in some girl's ass. It was a wild morning.
It was the Fonz. It was really bizarre.
It was a wild morning, to say the least. But
you know why I got a Jaegermeister machine. I haven't even used it.
You never heard the Jaegermeister story?
No, I didn't hear it.
So we're off the air for, 2.5 years? We come
26
back.
26 months.
26 months. And we come back, and we were only back on the radio a month or two, and then we almost got fired again. Because we had this Jaegermeister machine, and the wiffle ball bat challenge still happening. And a girl took the wiffle ball bat maybe a little too far, and everyone was hammered. But they were hammered before they got there. That's the truth.
But how did she take it too far?
Yeah, what does that mean, she took it too far?
One of the girls wanted to set the record, so she fucking pushed a little too hard.
And what happened?
The girl was very uncomfortable. Nothing bad. There was no medical attention was needed, but it was a sign telling us, wow, we got to calm the fuck down. And Jimmy pretty much yelled at me at a diner, like, what the fuck are we doing?
This was November.
And then I'm like, yeah, I think you're making a pretty good point here, sir.
So everyone got drunk on the air with Jaeger shots?
No, it was a band that came in, and I forgot exactly, but I guess they were bringing the girls in if we would promote their music or something like that. And they all came in really fucked up to begin with. And then we happened to have the Jägermeister machine. And then everyone was pretty much naked. One girl tried to leave the studio by, climbing out a window. She thought that was the door. Remember that? She walked right by me. There was no exit. She was trying to find an exit where there obviously was no door. That was the first sign. And then Jimmy takes off with a girl for a while.
Not that long. No, absolutely not. She was so drunk, and I was fucked. I couldn't believe we fucked at work.
And then
what was she on a scale of 1 to 10?
I don't even remember, dude. This is literally November of 2004. I would say she was cute. I mean, I was attracted to her.
We were back a month.
We came back in October, and this was November. And I remember just banging around that desk or whatever was in there.
Yeah.
It was a desk.
And then one of the girls walked out of the building completely naked and then decided to, like, lay on the sidewalk and started crying.
Oh, and that's the and then everyone, you guys were on 57th Street, those
studios. Yeah,
and
then the building called, like, everybody. Let's just put it this way. The building called everybody. And then, I don't know.
You know when Jim Norton is the reason for, the voice of reason for debauchery that you went too far.
And then the company started asking a few questions, and then Jimmy, we went to the diner, I forgot with who, and then Jimmy's just yelling, what the fuck are we doing?
I saw us throwing
it away.
We were
just off the air for 26 months.
But he also said that after he came.
Yeah, it's true. With a full fucking nut. I tell you what I was doing. Come here, madam. I know you have a problem with alcohol. And then Ralphie May helped us that day a lot, man, by talking to the cop, and they didn't take the girl. They didn't do it. Something they were going to do, and they didn't do it. Like, they just kind of didn't do a report or whatever. Mm-hmm. And that helped us, man, because that would have been a major problem.
Yeah. Well, I think Ralphie thinks I hate him or something. I don't know. There was some weird shit online the other day.
Yeah, people were tweeting me about it, too.
Ralphie
had no problems with Ralphie May. Ralphie and we've had him. We've had him on the show and within the last year or two, and we all got along.
He had a little thing on Twitter the other day. I don't know what's going on with him, but he seems very depressed.
Yeah.
He's a good dude, man.
He's
not a dick. He started, like, going after Chelsea because she called her special one of the greats.
Right.
Which is, like, really a very literal, like, if you know her, it's obviously it's being sarcastic and joking.
But why would he go after her for that?
Just, he was in a weird frame of mind, I think. Like, you know, he wasn't...
Was it based on something he did?
No, just lashing out.
There's some personal stuff going on.
Oh, well. Yeah,
I think so.
I don't know. I'll reach out to Ralphie May, but I don't have a problem with you, Ralphie. I love you.
I wouldn't take anything he said that day to heart. He seems to just be lashing out.
Yeah. All right.
Talking about being depressed and, like, alcohol and suicidal or, like, you know, really sad. It's like, I don't know if his marriage is breaking up, but he said he's losing his wife and kids, so maybe he's just having a hard time.
Suicidal.
He alluded to that, yeah.
Jesus.
Yeah. But he's never been a dick. Like, Ralphie's never lashed out at people, so.
Right.
The guy has a fucking rough day on Twitter. But that's why Twitter fucking terrifies me. Like, you know, like, thank God it didn't exist. You know, I know that I would wake up and just look at it and go, oh, no.
I tweet
I have an active
that.
Timeline. Oh, no.
I got an active timeline.
Oh, no. I vaguely remember saying, I have feelings for you. Oh, please don't let me have tweeted that.
Got an active timeline. You don't even know what it is yet.
No.
Oh, you just know it's active. You're like, oh, no. You're just scrolling very slowly, like,
imagine waking up and you have vague memories of writing something. Oh, no. I tweeted my dick.
Especially
the fucking human dick, so what? Like, oh, I know I would ruin my life.
Especially when you were a lot younger, just trying to get some tail, as we used to say. Wow. The shit you would say on Twitter. No, Ralphie, I love you. I don't know what you said, but people were tweeting at me, like, what is Ralphie's problem with you or something like that? And it was a little vague, and he thinks we don't like him or something. I don't know. Last time we had you on, everything was good. Everything was good. He gave us a great phone call. So I hope he's doing well. All right? Where were we? Oh, so the Jägermeister machine was yanked immediately.
And you had a talking to from the higher-ups?
They were pretty cool. They were sniffing around a little bit. You know, what saved us was we were our own entity. Like, we had no bosses in that area, so that no one saw anything. So we were able to clean up the situation. We brought in the wolf.
Right. Nice. Yeah, you couldn't pull it off in this building.
No, we would have been really fucked.
Yeah.
But then we probably wouldn't have taken those type of chances.
Yeah.
That was the cool thing about being over there by ourselves. You could take all sorts of chances. No one was babysitting us. And everyone from that band and the girls, everyone was cool in the end. But it was just, you know, talking to the authorities in such a way. And I think we had a fan or two, you know, among them that helped us out.
Right.
So then Jimmy was the voice of reason, said, what the fuck? And we got rid of the Jägermeister machine, I think, pretty much immediately. And then we retired the wiffle ball bat. It was retired.
Mm.
Girls used to take that in the ass, too.
Really? How far?
You weren't around?
No, I never was. I wasn't around for those days.
It was in a glass case.
I know you guys used to do it. I didn't know how far.
It was in a glass case, and then, you know, the girl would put, you know, it whatever, and then we would mark it off, and then she would sign her name, and it would be dated, and she would be the champion.
So it was all professional.
Yes!
And then it was the same wiffle ball bat. They used the same one,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, it had the fucking hygiene of a Middle Ages torture device.
And then we would put it back in the glass box until the next time, and every once in a while, a girl would want to do it, and then she would try to beat the record, and you can only go so far, obviously. Yeah. That's where we ran into problems because every girl wanted bragging rights. So they're like, no, I think I can do more. And she would move her body in some weird fucking pose to maybe try to get some more in there. And then one girl's like, screw this. And she decided to, she knew she couldn't do it the regular way because that line was way high. So she's like, well, let me start a new record. And then she put it in her ass. And then that became a thing for a while. It's crazy. Dude, it was crazy.
And what could they win? What
bragging rights.
That was it? It wasn't like
It was just bragging rights. And then this wiffle ball bat was just in a glass case, just proudly displayed.
Where is that now?
I think we threw it in the fucking dumpster.
Yeah.
Or gave it to a fan or something?
No, I'm kidding. Yeah, I think we gave it to a fan. Some fan out there has that.
Yeah, you don't need that in storage.
No.
If you want to do that again now, would Sirius let you do it?
Oh, God, no.
All lawyers, everybody would stop you from doing all that stuff.
No, Bubba fucking wrecked that for everybody.
Bubba?
Which is probably a good thing.
What'd he do?
He did something, and then they had to actually put it on the books that you're not allowed to penetrate women anymore on the radio.
Really?
Because, I swear to God.
Because of something Bubba did?
Yes.
Really?
Yes.
Well, he was doing a thing where he was shocking their pussies.
Shocking?
Oh, that's right.
What? Shock the Puss, it was called. Yeah.
Bubba? Shock the Pussy?
Yeah. Yeah.
He had like a cattle prod or something, yeah.
Shock jock.
It's good.
He's done some crazy shit. I mean, when I was on a show in Tampa and I would go down and do gigs, every time I was in there, there was some fucking insane thing going on.
Yeah, those days are over. I don't need to be doing any of that stuff anyway. It was fun. I don't regret it or anything, but maybe it's a good thing that the company came up with a no penetration rule.
Could be the first company besides porn.
I know. Can you imagine they actually had to write that out with lawyers? So
he Bubba's. I'm surprised he never got in huge trouble for that.
But which thing?
Any of them?
Yeah.
Mm.
His producer reached out like a week ago to me again, wanting to know if we wanted to talk to him on the air.
Why don't we?
I'm trying to.
If he reached out, why wouldn't
his producer wanted to see if we were still interested? And I said, of course. Just let us know when.
What's he up to these days?
I don't know.
Is he still on that station?
He is.
So they never got rid of him?
Nope.
See, everyone thought they were going to fire him for that stuff.
That's what
they
kept saying.
Yeah. Interesting. Huh.
Yeah.
Ratings are great.
Mm-hmm.
Ratings are great.
Well, it's because he's accused of...
Oh, right.
Weren't you guys fighting at some point?
Yeah,
I guess.
A while ago.
I fought with everybody.
Right.
Yeah.
I can't keep track anymore.
But when
all
these stories came out, Opie and Jimmy were very supportive.
Yeah.
And I think that's why he's entertaining the idea of...
Well,
I just understand it a little bit. It's right. Tough to say no to that. It's really tough to say no to that. I mean, because the pressure of getting ratings on regular radio and then... You know, you get a super fan. In our case, we would have super fans call us and go, hey, man, I got a diary. And you knew how important it was for one of your fans to have a diary, but you also knew you could get in a lot of trouble. So it was really tough to not tell them, you know, to fill it out with, like, you know, Opie and Anthony.
Right.
Back in the day, whatever. So I kind of get it in a way.
You'd get in Dutch for doing that.
Oh, you would get in a lot of fucking trouble for that. Yeah, I guess he wanted to beat me up in the octagon or something. I think he wanted to fight me in the octagon.
Do you remember what you said?
Nah, not really.
It wasn't like one thing. It wasn't you accused him of this or...
No.
Just shock jock stuff.
In a lot of cases, I didn't go after the person first. Mm. It was more just defending myself or the show or whatever.
Oh, Gregorio.
But he said next time he comes up, he wants to fight me in an octagon or something. Or if he sees me in the hall, he's going to, you know, beat me up.
It would be pretty cool to fight him in the octagon. You got to admit, that would be kind of cool.
I don't know. I think I could. I think I would do all right.
I think you'd do fine.
You know, if he fucking bear hugs me, I'm fucked.
Yeah, you just got to keep moving.
I got to keep fucking moving. Exactly. It's sticking.
Right.
Moving and
tire him out.
Tire him out a little bit. But if he got his arms around me, I'd be fucked. I have no problems with Bubba. I don't even know what the problem was back in the day.
Just radio stuff, man. People, you know, there's a lot of hours a day to talk on radio, you know, and it's like you run out of stuff to that's new, and all of a sudden you find out somebody badmouthed you, and it's not like, you know, on late night where you can address it really fast.
Mm-hmm.
You know, now you got an hour and 20 minutes to kill. All right, let's play the tape and go over. Whoa, stop.
Yeah.
Line by line, you know, it just gets really involved.
I don't even know what the issue was. I forget. I swear, I forgot.
I don't
know. It was a big thing a few years ago, but I don't even remember what started it. I really don't.
Yeah, I don't know. It's probably like one of those fucking, those weird things like the end of American Beauty. A couple of men have some feelings for each other.
That's not what happened.
That's my guess. Can I guess?
You think so? Guess. Yeah.
Well, a couple of men have feelings.
No,
so
that's a really bad guess.
All right, just
so who went in for the kiss out of the two?
I don't, you know, I couldn't even pinpoint it. It'd be easy to say Bubba did, but, you know, I've seen the look in his eyes across the radio.
Right.
See, I just don't
those little blue eyes shining.
So you think it might have been? Do you think it was Obi going in for it?
Maybe Bubba
and
went
Bubba
in for
goes,
the kiss.
Whoa, no!
No, just... Bubba went in for the kiss, but there was no, whoa. Yeah. It was like the head craned up a little.
Yeah,
a little neck craned. Yeah, a couple of men kissing.
All right.
Yeah.
Nothing you think maybe that. We just let Obi would let him kiss him on the neck?
It would start on the neck, and then it would be followed with.
How about you ask me? I'll answer these questions. Nah, why does Jimmy have to answer these questions?
You won't answer them.
Because you're shy. You're shy.
That's why I discuss this while I'm not here. That's one thing.
He'd kiss the neck, and it would giggle at first. Like,
no, I'm here to say that. I would not do that.
He wouldn't object angrily.
Right.
He wouldn't be like, get the fuck out.
Yeah, right.
Come on, stop.
Yeah, I'd be like, yeah.
Be gentle.
This isn't.
You want to ask me now, Jim?
How would you handle the kiss in the neck?
I would be very angry.
See, that's lies. Nothing but lies.
I would not be happy
about
that.
Okay, let's just say he came in for a kiss. Well, how angry did you get?
Why are
all your
scenarios gay scenarios?
Why wouldn't they be?
What is going on with you? Why do you need to know this info?
What would your reaction be?
Exactly.
Like if he came in, like the scene in American Beauty, and went to give you a kiss, what would your reaction be?
Because
you just said you would get angry.
I would, like one of those. Like there's a...
He'd throw a mint in his mouth real quick.
Like there's a mosquito on me, and I got to make sure I get it off before it...
And what would you say to Bubba? Like, what would you go, dude, you crossed the line? What do you think you might say?
I would probably say, I'm no fucking queer.
In your head. That's what you'd say in your head as those lips locked.
Right. Yeah, exactly.
That's what your mind would be saying as the tongue told a different story.
Right. Sorry about saying queer. I was doing it for comedic value.
Of course.
You could get in trouble for saying queer on the radio.
No, you can't. That's queer. I don't think so.
What about faggot?
Mm. I mean, it depends on how you're saying it, but... You know, I mean, if there's a mirror in front of you, I think it's acceptable.
All right. So
he's a good guy, Bubba.
I've never met him.
Did we even? I don't think we met. I'm trying to think. No, I don't think we ever met. So, whatever. I wish him well. Fuck it. Even though Mike Calta hates him. And
he does.
And I love Mike. You know, he's a really good dude.
But I never met Bubba, so I don't know what he's about. You know, whatever.
It's funny because he gave me one of his shirts to wear on that metal show one time, the Bubba Army shirts. I'm like, I'll wear it.
Yeah.
And I wore it, and I heard from like every other fucking radio show around the country, how could you wear his shirt? How come you're not wearing ours? I'm like, who the fuck knew all these radio shows had shirts? They were going fucking crazy. I can't believe you wore a fucking Bubba Army shirt. You don't wear this and this and this.
So you should have done an episode where every 2 minutes you're just putting on another radio station guy's shirt.
Yeah.
Do they all have armies?
Probably.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah. How big was the Bubba Army shirt? Does he make your size?
Yeah, he did. Yeah.
That had to be a special order. What are you, like a large, maybe a possible medium?
A large, yeah. They had a large.
Yeah, that must have been tough for him to make. That was a one and done.
It really is.
One large shirt for Jim Florentine.
Was there an Opie and Anthony Army?
Well, there's an ONA pass.
No, we well, the pass, I guess. Who have, I guess they all turned on us, I hear, but what are you going to do?
Some have, not all of them.
I hope not all.
Some of them have issues with the particular state of the show and certain Jim Norton qualities, which I take great umbrage with those issues.
Jim Norton qualities?
I certainly do.
What does that mean?
What?
They question my my new videos.
Oh. They're wonderful videos, though.
I think so, too. I think a little positivity is what they need.
I think everyone could use a little positivity in their lives. There's the Bubba Army shirt on Jameson. So you're lying.
No, I wore it, too. I wore it on when Kirk Hammett was on the show.
Oh, you're sharing a shirt?
No, I had a different one.
Yeah?
He had a bunch of different Bubba Army ones.
Yeah, we never had an army. We had Pess. We thought that was kind of cool for, you know, back in
the day. Oh, I know, because another time I promoted Jason Ellis' book on the show, and I heard a lot from your fans that he's an asshole. I guess you guys were fighting with him, which I didn't know.
I have no problems with Jason Ellis either. The story with Jason Ellis is very simple. I actually liked his show, and I thought it could work on this channel. You know, not everything not everything's going to work, obviously, but I really thought it would work with our fan base. So we gave it a shot, and it just didn't work.
Right, it was on this channel for a while, right? Was it repeated on this channel? Or
yeah. No, he was on what happened was he was on the channel, and we always liked it. I didn't really listen to the show, but I liked him as a guy. I think I've done his show, and it was fun. He was a cool dude.
I've done his show.
He was, and he would come on. And then I think he came on Howard before.
Right.
And I don't, where he thanked Howard in his book or something and not Opie and Anthony. And it was kind of like, well, hey, you know, those the guys that put.
Yeah,
but then it gets, it's like the radio shit. It just gets spun out of control. Right.
Yeah, I actually didn't have a problem with the guy. It's unfortunate it didn't work out because I thought it could have worked on this channel. And then he came in a few times. He kind of tried to alpha male us, which kind of made us all go, yuck. And that's the truth, though. And then, you know, then we just have moved on. I saw him in the hallway. I shook his hand and said, I don't have an issue with you. And that was it.
I would have, too, if I were you. He's a fucking, looks like a biker. He's a fucking frightening guy. Bald with tattoos on his head. I didn't recognize. I saw him at the Apollo, the Springsteen show, I think.
Or Metallica show, yeah.
I didn't recognize him because he's now his hair is gone. I'm like, who's this fucking psychopath? And he's like, hey. I'm like, oh, Jesus.
Right. My new thing is I give Howard Stern a peppy good morning. Because we're passing each other in the hall almost every morning now.
How did that happen?
I started with a nice, you know, good morning, and it didn't go anywhere. And then I decided to pep it up a little bit. He's still not acknowledging that I'm saying good morning to him, even though our shoulders are pretty much brushing each other in the hallway. And I think I'm going to go with a fist bump next time we see him. I'm just going to put my fist up.
Yeah, you can't get in trouble. Just tell me it was like a black power thing or not.
Enough is enough. We pass each other in the hall, so I just say good morning, and he just.
What is the end game here? Is it to try to get a reaction out of him, or to see how far you can push?
First of all, I'm not trying to push him. Your jacket, Justin. You can ask any questions you like, but not with your jacket fucking zipped up to your chin. You're not six.
I was freezing.
I know,
you're
sweetie,
not freezing.
I'm telling you, I'm freezing. I'm not get his six. Fucking jacket zipped up like he's. I know.
Now he's got it like three quarters, like Fonzie.
No, it's all. Can we go through your bag of pills today?
No, I have a big bag of pills.
I just saw that. Did you see the prescription thugs yet?
Not yet.
Documentary?
I'm dying to see.
We got the guy coming in tomorrow, Chris Bell.
Oh, no.
I saw his movie last night.
I might ring him.
Get ring his bell.
That is.
Safe to say, we have a prescription drug problem in this country. And the movie Prescription Thugs is pretty damn good.
Is it a documentary?
Yes. Yeah.
You know, Howard, I've seen him in the halls, too. I think he misunderstood something. Because I walked by him a couple of times.
Yeah.
And I was, I said, I'm available. You guys get in early, man.
And he misunderstood.
How funny is it, though, that he's getting in to do his show? Oh, no, it is the same time the show is just starting.
No, okay. He took our lead and moved his show to 7. Because we realized a long time ago, it's just stupid to start this shit at 6. It's just dumb.
Yeah.
Especially when the thing runs all day long and you got on demand. No, my end game is just for him to say good morning back. Why not? I don't need or want anything from the guy.
But is it to try to mend fences, or you just enjoying the game?
That's a great question. From Aunt Justin. Do you want to mend fences, Gregory?
Do you want to mend fences?
Yeah, but do you want to heal all wounds? And do you want water under the bridge, Howard? What is the end game, though?
Just I'll say, hey, good morning. That's it. I don't expect to, you know, be on a show or anything.
Right.
But if you pass the guy in the hall and you know you've had some history over the years, fuck it. I just decided to start saying good morning. I'm gonna do the fist bump next, though.
I saw this happen yesterday, by the way.
What did you? Am I lying?
I saw the whole thing happen.
Am I lying?
For the first time.
He gets really mad.
He was looking
at me. He hates that he has to pass me in the hall. I'm like, what?
We were the only people there.
Yeah.
And he just, it was like there was nobody there looking at it. I said good morning in a loud voice. He couldn't have not heard it.
Yeah.
Just no response.
Well, were you guys together?
Yeah. I was in front of Opie.
Well, if you were alone, he probably would have said hello to you. I don't think you're the problem.
Yeah, he says hi to me.
Then there's no problem.
Why
go back
am
to your
I such
show.
A bother with this guy?
He says hi to me in the hall.
He
all
took
fun.
His fucking shots, too. Relax. I'm not bothered by the shots you took. I don't know. So it's at least... I would say it's at least four times I've seen him since he changed his schedule, and boy, not a word. I hear a lot of mumbling so as we pass each other. Like, oh, all right, I'll try again. I'm going with the fist bump next time. I want to film that so bad. Just me walking home, hoping for a fist bump. Anyway,
you know who else is might have made up is Sammy Hagar and Eddie Van Halen.
No,
yeah, Sammy wished Eddie. Happy birthday on Twitter yesterday, and Eddie wrote back, hey, Sammy, thanks. Hope you're well.
No kidding.
Yeah. Could be huge news.
I think
they haven't talked since, like, 2005.
Eddie's birthday, he was 61 yesterday, I think?
I think so, yeah.
Wow. I didn't know that happened.
Yeah, it just happened yesterday.
Mending fences. It's wonderful to see fences being mended. Am I right or wrong, Paul? You're over there nodding.
Happy birthday, Eddie. Hope
he's
you're doing good.
He's trying not to pass out.
Are you okay?
Fine.
All right. I don't want you here if you're not feeling well. You deserve a day off. Paul's very good.
Yes.
Excellent.
It says, happy birthday, Eddie. Hope you're doing well. Hashtag 5150 time. Best of both worlds is the other hashtag. And then what? Oh, and then Eddie writes, like you said, thanks, Sammy. Hope you're well, too. Wow.
Wow, the guy who's running Sammy Hagar's account really loves the guy who loves Eddie.
I think Sammy definitely does his. I don't know if Eddie does his, but...
He would have probably cleared that before he responded.
Yeah, if it's one of his assistants, there's no way he's going to put that out there without asking Eddie.
No. Let me ask you this. When was the last time Sammy played with Eddie?
2004.
I think 2004, 2005.
So it's been 11, 12 years. Yeah, people would want to see that shit again. They would want to see that.
Well, you know, they just finished up the stuff with Dave.
Uh-huh.
And so, there's rumors Dave wants to do his solo band with Steve Vai and Billy Sheehan, his Eat 'Em and Smile band.
David wants to do
yeah,
that?
Yeah, he wants to. Yeah, they were going to do one show out in L.A., and then he's thinking about it, so who knows? And maybe, they just did two tours, Van Halen, the last, like, 6 years with Dave, and maybe, you know...
Yeah.
They both had enough of each other, and Eddie's thinking, why not do a run with Sammy? I don't know.
They got along
no
pretty well, right, this last time?
I think so, yeah. But, you know, Dave's always said him and Eddie are just never going to be friends. They just, you know.
They're different
we
people.
We can work together, but it's never going to be.
Yeah, right. They're just different people, man.
Yeah.
They made each other fucking a lot of money.
Yeah. And they put up with
happens.
Each other.
It's not, you know, it's one of those things where it's just, you know, they just didn't get along.
Yeah.
But they did great radio for a long time.
No.
Van Halen. Yes.
Yeah, the chemistry on stage.
A lot of this band stuff I can relate to. It's so strange.
Yeah, the chemistry on stage is, you know, looks like they're buddies. And when I used to watch the walkovers on video, it looked like you guys are buddies. Yeah, I don't know what happened. You guys played it off well.
No, it was.
It happens with bands. Fuck, Keith Richards and Mick Jagger hated each other forever.
Did they really? And Keith Richards, the funny thing about those guys is Keith refers to Mick as what does he say, his highness or some feminine term. Like, Keith is really the one guy in life that could just say to fucking Mick Jagger, shut up, you fucking fruit, and he has to shut up. He's like the only guy on earth that could talk to Mick Jagger like that.
They definitely needed each other.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Very talented, but you needed Mick Jagger's organization.
Yeah, Mick runs all that Mick shit runs together. Mick like books, like, the tours and stuff like that.
He does
books the
everything.
Flights. He does everything.
He books the flights?
Yeah. No.
More or less, he does everything. And then Keith Richards.
Pretty much. Like, he's got an assistant, but Mick just controls the whole thing, makes up the set list, and does all that stuff.
The
but
business.
Yeah, he does it all. He's like, We don't need an agent. We don't need anything. I'll do it.
And then Keith Richards just wakes up in the middle of the night in a drunken stupor and comes up with the most amazing fucking riffs ever and forgets that he even did it until he plays back his tape. That's the two guys.
Yeah.
So Mick's
that worked.
I wonder why Mick. I wonder why Mick does that. Maybe he wants to control his money and not get ripped off.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, maybe.
Which is very smart. But or I wonder if some guys just like it. It's cathartic. Like I do laundry at home, and I know that's different than booking a Rolling Stones tour. But there are just things in life you do which just feel like, hey, I'm doing something that I don't need to do or whatever, but I like doing. And I wonder if he gets something out of that besides protect, because he can find someone he could trust.
Yeah.
Like, does he just feel, like, comforted doing that? Like, it's a normal guy thing to do?
I would assume he had guys throughout the years and then finally said, fuck, I could just do all this myself. And maybe he started not trusting people.
Yeah, I mean, like,
as much.
If they want to play, you know, MetLife Stadium, he doesn't need an agent to go, you know, right. Call them up direct and go, all right, we want $5 million.
You know how much you can get?
And he's got people around still.
Yeah, absolutely.
But he's overseen all those people, right? I would assume.
Yeah, I would say so. I know Keith would always get aggravated because Mick would want to do a solo album and a solo tour. And he's like, look, just focus on the Stones. Why are you going out for a year? You know, playing like, you know, 1,500 seats when we could be out doing stadiums.
I never liked the solo stuff.
Some of his stuff was okay.
I liked Keith Richards' solo stuff because it was a little dirtier.
His last record was pretty good, Keith, put one out like 4 months ago.
I saw the documentary on making that record.
Yeah.
It's pretty good.
It might keep them, but that's maybe how come they're still around. Like, you need breathers, man. For us, it sounds like forever. But for the Stones, it's not crazy that they don't go out for 8 months.
Yeah.
So maybe you go out, you do something, you take a breather, then you're happy to see the guy again. You know, who knows? That shit does happen.
Could you say breather again?
Did I say breather? Did I say it wrong?
No, you're just saying it a lot.
Oh, am I saying breather a lot? I do say breather a lot.
It's one of your favorite words,
yes,
I think.
Yes, it certainly is, because I don't breathe well. I want to be a good breather.
I guess the Keith Richards story, was it Satisfaction? That was the guitar riff?
Stones?
That's right. It was
Keith Richards wakes up in the middle of the fucking night, the story goes, picks up his guitar and does the riff for Satisfaction, I think. Someone help me out. Or was it Brown Sugar? I think it was Satisfaction. And then goes back to sleep or whatever, passes out again. And then he noticed that, he did something in the middle of the night with the tape recorder near his bed and played it back and swears he doesn't remember doing it.
That's a pretty cool thing to have.
Can you imagine if he never pushed record on that?
Well, can you imagine the ones he hasn't pushed record on?
Exactly.
So there's a lot of Satisfactions out there. And there's probably also a lot of fucking dancing in the streets. You know, so we might have missed out on a few duds, too.
That's rough.
You didn't like that one?
No. The video turned me on, but I didn't really enjoy the song.
South America! Doesn't he start screaming countries?
That's when him and Bowie did it, right?
Yes.
But I think they did that for Live Aid, though, right?
I think so.
Oof. Doesn't matter what they did it for.
Yeah, I know. The videos.
I'd rather go hungry.
All right, here
you saw the video?
Yes, I did. I'm not a fan.
No.
People have been making fun of that video forever.
No, I know. It's
literally... It's the gayest thing I've ever seen, and brother, is that saying a lot?
You think? You think they blew each other?
Well, that was that.
They
you
did.
Know,
I've heard that they were sexual.
That rumor that you know Bowie's wife at the time, Angie, walked in on him.
Is that the black girl? There was a black girl who said she had I was reading about with that whole. Remember we talked yesterday about the. Carol Miller thing that kind of it's another book by a girl a black girl who was like a groupie or something or she was a model and she hooked up with after Bowie died she hooked up with Bowie she hooked up with Jagger and I think she was saying I was the cream in the sandwich or I was the whatever Jeez. In the sandwich she was saying she look her up she's
yeah.
a very pretty black girl that Bowie dated for a long time and she talked about fucking them together she's like they were very close friends.
Didn't actually say that they were, you know, with each other.
No, she was saying that she was in there. Believe me, don't fucking think that, you know, fucking those Jagger lips. Don't think that girl's blowing you. If you see Jagger's lips, you're not just going to jam it in there to be a fucking silly goose. It happened.
Oh, wow. Mick Jagger affair with David Bowie claimed a new book. This is from 2012. I think we talked about this.
Ava Cherry?
No, she's a black girl. That girl couldn't be whiter.
AVA Cherry.
Yes.
Yep.
That girl?
No, that looks like... Go down a little bit. Go back a little bit. That girl, what is that thing on her head? Is that really her hair?
I don't know what the fuck that
is. Who is that?
I'm waiting for the Robert Reed reference.
That was his... wow, yes, a former wife, Angie. I was watching recently when we made fun of... Remember when we did the fucking Brady Bunch Variety Hours?
Sure.
That was online recently. God damn, that made me laugh. That's
very
fucking
funny.
Fucking stupid Robert Reed and hairdo.
Is that the Angie from the Rolling Stones song?
Wait, no, Angie was Bowie's wife,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah, but man, were you singing about Bowie's wife?
Yes, that was.
I think so.
Yeah.
Are you joking, Jim?
No, it was.
No.
It was. The Rolling Stones song, Angie, was about Bowie's wife.
Are you kidding? I didn't know that.
Yeah.
I think so.
I always wondered who that was about.
Because they all hung out together.
Amazing song.
All these people just hung out together and were writing songs about each other's chicks.
Can you imagine if someone wrote a song about your wife, how weird that would be, and it was a good one?
Yeah, exactly.
It's weird when he goes, Angie. I hate when he whispers her name. Let me whisper in your ear. You don't have to do that. I know what whispering sounds like. It's one of my favorite Stone songs, but I don't like that part.
Yeah.
Pronounced her name very strangely. Could you go back to the Satisfaction story?
Mm-hmm. It's a good song.
Here's how the story goes for the people that don't know. In the early hours of May 7th, 1965, Keith and the Stones were back at their hotel rooms in Clearwater, Florida. Wow. As they just finished another stop on their tour.
They've been famous for a long time.
Yeah.
These guys have lived. What a life Mick Jagger has had.
Keith woke up after he heard a new riff in a dream. Wow, that's pretty cool. According to his take in blah, blah, blah. So he got out of bed and recorded the riff on his portable tape recorder, then went back to sleep. The next day, he rewound the tape recorder and rediscovered what he had recorded the night before, which begs the question, did he even remember doing it? He played the riff for Mick Jagger and told him the words, "I can't get no satisfaction," which he got from the Chuck Berry song, 30 Days.
Wow, that's funny that he got that from a Chuck Berry song. We've heard the Chuck Berry song. It's not as good. Satisfaction by the Stone. How's that go? I've heard the riff. I don't remember it.
No, you're kidding.
No. I know the name of the song, and I know I've heard it.
Satisfaction?
It calls for... Bow, bow,
now, he's now, setting now. Us up.
No, I'm not.
I know. Yeah.
He's setting us up.
I know the song. I know I've heard it.
He's setting us up.
He's setting us up.
His acting is getting getting better.
He's not blinking, though.
He's doing good.
He's not blinking.
I'm trying not to blink anyway. I haven't been blinking. I'm a calmer person lately. I've been sleeping better.
You know the song.
I know the song. I know I've heard it. But I don't... I can't... If you said to me to do the riff, I could not do the riff.
Joining us now from Des Moines, Iowa, Republican
Senator.
That's
not it.
What?
That's not...
Ross item.
I don't know where it is.
It's not back there?
Oh, I thought you were doing it.
Yeah, I mean, I just figure that he pulls up everything now, so I don't...
Okay. Ooh!
Oh!
It's true. I mean, I'm halfway through pulling up things, and then I see him playing it.
Somebody's fucking slided in the other room. Ooh.
You want satisfaction?
Excuse me. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Sure. I was kidding, of course.
Does this sound familiar?
Thank God, yeah.
The eyes got really big.
I couldn't help it.
All right.
I almost laughed a couple of times when Jim was looking at me.
We never know.
He got me, though.
And you know where the Rolling Stones got their name from, right?
Yeah, because the people, somebody said to them, "You guys never have moss on you." And they said, "You know, it's funny you should ask."
That's exactly right. That's exactly right.
I don't know how.
From Seven Dust just checked in. All right. I just got a message.
What time is it?
Seven Dust is going to be performing for us today.
Sweet Tigger.
Oh, boy.
And they have to set up in here.
Yeah.
Oh, let's take a break and make love.
We're going to take a break. Rolling Stones got their name from Muddy Waters.
Oh, really?
Yes. That's where they got their name from. All right. We should take a break so these guys could set up. We got Seven Dust. This is cool.
They're going to sing a couple songs, too.
Yeah, man.
Nice.
The only two of the guys are in, obviously, because it's an acoustic set.
That's very cool. All right. So we got seven. We got a busy fucking show. JB Smoove
is coming in.
First time, right?
Yeah, I love JB.
You were on his show. I'm a fan of Four Courses with JB Smoove.
Yeah, I did that show
the
too.
That's great. Network. Big fan of that. He gets some good guests.
Yeah, he gets great guests. And boy, the people watch that fucking show, man.
It's on
MSG. I've been recognized so many times from being on that show. I cannot tell you.
Well, here's the deal. When they don't have a Knicks game, they put that show on. It's in reruns all the fucking time. It's 9 out of 10 whatever.
I'm doing
what
Jerry Cooney.
Gives a fuck.
I did it with Jerry Cooney one time, and he's great, man. I would love to have him on the show. I'm doing his. He has a boxing show here, and I think it's on Fridays.
Yeah,
he's fucking.
I'd have him in tomorrow. We're from the same hometown.
Really lucid, but he's a guy. He's an older
Huntington
guy.
Boy.
And he walks into a room and he wears a sweater vest. But you're like, that's still a guy. You know, who could fucking punch you through a brick wall.
Yeah.
He's just got that. He's got like that, like grab you by the shoulders. Hey, energy with those big fucking mitts. He's awesome, man.
And he does a lot of good things for fighters.
Yes, he does. Really, he cares about them. Yeah, he's great.
Yeah, he was a legend in Huntington, man. He would walk around Main Street Huntington every once in a while, and people would just follow him. Like,
you think he still throws a rough punch?
Oh. Absolutely. Fucking lutely.
We got a break. We're going to be fucking 2 hours late.
All right. Florentine?
Valentine's Day weekend. I'll be in Fort Myers Laughing Comedy Club and then Improv in Cleveland February 18th through 21.
And Jay Williams is coming in today, too.
Yes.
I want to mention that. He had a promising NBA career, and it all went to shit. He's got a story to tell, so he's got a new book coming out. And Jimmy's going to be where?
Louisville in two. Not this weekend, but the weekend after at the Laughing Derby. You know, it's a hat with humor. And then February 11th, I go to Chicago. The 12th is Michigan. 13th is Wisconsin.
Jesus.
A whole bunch of gigs coming up now. And I'm very, very psyched about this tour.
Very cool.
I'm getting tour shirts made.
Are you really?
Yep. It'll be nice. I'll have them for years, I'm sure. To sell.
I'll buy one.
Nice.
I'll sell it to you.
Seven Dust next. Nice. We're back. We've got Jim Florentine in studio. Jim Norton's, what do you think he's doing? You think he's dumping?
Yeah.
He's dumping a little bit. And we got Seven Dust in the studio. We're a couple of the guys from Seven Dust. LeJean, what's up, buddy?
What's up? How you doing, man?
It's been a while.
New York City's. What's up, y'all?
New York!
What time is it?
And Clint, right?
Yes, sir.
What's up, Clint?
Not too much, man. Just,
it's early for you guys, right?
Well, you know, and besides that, the weird thing about it is us flying into New York City 3 days after, what'd they say, the worst snowstorm in the history of the United States of this America?
Yeah, or the second worst. It was really bad. Yeah.
That's when we fly in. That's we wait for the weather to be the worst. And then
you're talking about Snowzilla.
You know, it's
Snowzilla.
Crazy.
When did you come in? When did you actually fly in?
Well, we got here yesterday evening.
From where?
From Kansas City.
Oh, okay.
In St. Louis. But funny thing about it, our Uber driver today said, where are you guys from? It's like St. Louis. I'm like Kansas City. And he looks over and he's like, welcome to New York. And it's like a 17-foot tall wall of snow and trash. I was like, well, this is how we like it.
Yeah, it's nice.
They're getting rid of the snow quickly, though.
Right on, man. Well, it's a pleasure to be here with you gentlemen.
I'm bothered by the fact that Seven Dust is taking Ubers. Where's like a limo for you guys or some kind
Does anyone still use limos?
Oh, man. Like,
we said
Rod Stewart was the last guy to use an actual real limo.
No,
I feel like an idiot getting climbing out of one of those.
Am
anyway.
I asking the 1980 rock question?
Yeah. Listen, I'm old school enough to buy me an old Cadillac limousine and have it in my yard.
Limos are hack at this point. It's for proms, and that is it.
There you go.
Celebrities are in big-ass SUVs.
Yeah.
But you should have at least had an SUV, is what Jimmy's saying.
Yeah,
not an Uber.
What's going on?
We could have sent someone to pick you guys up in style.
We're out of here.
Uber driver.
You would have to pay for it.
Creepy.
Huh?
Uber drivers are getting creepy. I was dating a girl, and she said that every time she'd go home, I didn't know. I would send her an Uber every day. And she's like, yeah, the guys were asking me to get in the front seat with them.
Oh, wow.
Like, the guys were really creepy.
Saying, really?
Yeah, sit up front with them. Because they're regular guys. Yeah. They're not used to having hot girls just get in the car.
Let's date for 5 minutes.
Text her later. How was the drive? Was it all right?
Getting an Uber is really strange because it's, like, so personal. It's, you know, you're in someone's actual personal car, and they're moving things so you could sit down.
Yeah.
Let me clear the back seat for you so you have a nice seat.
Right.
It's Clint, strange,
isn't it? Clint, did the guy ask you to get in the front seat?
You should have known.
Well, you know, I mean, usually they'll have something in the front seat to kind of deter you. They're not that type of driver.
Right.
But usually it's usually, you know, they're kind of open to it. That's their whole thing. Like, check it out, man. We're loose here. You know?
Well, now that we're talking about this, there's definitely a Playboy Uber driver that's, like, lambasting everybody in the city.
Yeah, I would imagine. There's some guys getting some action.
There you go. taxi drivers gotta love the Uber guy.
It's a whole different subject. Well, I get into a cab yesterday morning, and I'm like, I gotta go to this this place in Brooklyn or two mornings ago. And he's like, yeah, no, I know. And he's like, where's your GPS? These Uber guys have everything on a map. It's like, no wonder everybody's using this fucking this system. Cabbies stink.
And now, yeah, now the city's pissed off at the Uber people, and they're trying to, you know, push them out a little bit or knock down their numbers. It's like, and we've talked about it on the show, the cabs had a huge lead in that department and allowed the competition to come in and do it better. So.
Oh, yeah, definitely, man. I've met some guys that, one gentleman, this last tour we just did, I did an Uber, and he's like, man, this is my full-time job. This is what I do. And I'm like, wow, well, you go ahead on. He's doing good. So, hey, that's off to him, man.
Yeah.
You guys have been around for 20 years. It's 20 years? Yeah. Is that true?
Yeah, we signed a record deal here in New York City at TVT Records about a zillion years ago, man. We've been around for a minute.
We're like a classic rock band.
Yeah.
We're like, you know, Foghat. We're taking over for Foghat. Right. Like, thanks for the old band for us.
It's definitely been a pleasure to be around this long and to see all the bands to come up and go and to be appreciated still. It's a blessing. What more could you
have? A lot of bands have come and gone. I mean, we got a channel here on Sirius Lithium and band after band that used to like or at least a few songs from them. You're like, wow, where did these guys go?
Absolutely. Absolutely, man.
And we met way back at AAF when you guys were first starting out. Me and Ant were first starting out, and you guys were first starting out. And now it's 20 years.
We were kids. We were burning it down back then. Wow.
Yeah. Me and Jim saw you guys at the Viper Room when your record first came out.
Seriously? Yeah. With the cage in front of
it. Yeah. I don't even remember.
It it was our first day ever in L.A. for me and Jim. We're filming.
No.
Yeah. And we were staying at the hotel right behind the Viper Room, and we said, we got to go over to Viper Room. And we walked in, and you guys were playing. We're like, who the fuck are these guys? Yes. These guys are amazing.
I remember that. I remember Johnny Depp's guy, the business guy, little Irish guy that owned the place with them. I remember that yesterday.
Yeah. And I think we stayed at that same hotel.
Yeah, we did. Right. What's the guy from Remington Steele, the actor?
Pierce Brosnan.
I remember seeing him that day, and I was like, Remington Steele!
Well, such a random guy to be there.
He's him and his wife were like, hey, I'm like, I'm sorry, that's the school I'm from.
You do see the most random. The first celebrity I ever saw in L.A. was John Forsythe from Dynasty.
What an odd person to see.
Will Ferrell almost ran over me and Vinny on Sunset, coming across the street from the Viper, going to the barbershop, and he came down the hill, and I promise you, he was doing 50 miles per hour, and turned the corner, and it was a Rolls Royce, and I was like, damn, that was Will Ferrell, just almost hit us. That would have been kind of cool.
Yeah. That'd been a nice story, yeah.
That would have been a wonderful story. You would have had some of that Will Ferrell money.
Yeah, this is a true story right here.
How many countries have you guys been to?
All of them.
We've been to weird places for the military. We did Afghanistan, Iraq. We've been everywhere, man.
What country really loves Seven Dust outside of America?
Australia. Look at the view. We can't wait to get back there. It's been 6 years, and we'll be back in March, which we look forward to.
How long do you go? I've never been there either, and it's the one place I'm dying to go to. Everybody says it's awesome.
Man, it's a
beautiful place. We stayed for like 10 shows is basically all you can do there. Mm-hmm. I mean, they're New Zealand and Australia.
And you fly everywhere. That's a weird thing. You know, you can't really do a tour bus thing, so we fly from...
Why is that?
I guess the trip would probably be too long, so we fly from Adelaide to Sydney to Melbourne to Brisbane. And we'll do that whole run, probably for about a 2.5-week run over there.
No, that's pretty cool.
That's going to be cool. We look forward to it.
I heard the women there are pretty lovely. Yeah. Australia.
Well, today is me and my wife's 12-year anniversary.
Cool.
And she's very beautiful, too, but yes, they are.
Man, happy anniversary.
Man. Thank you. You're so good. My wife's listening. Like, you're an idiot.
You know what's funny, man? I promise. It's a true story. We were in Australia the first time, and for whatever reason, our hotel was right next door to a pharmacy. And we walked in, and the lady had blonde hair. And she was this beautiful lady. And I just wanted, you know, she knew about the band and everything. And I asked her, and I think she said she was 70 years old, didn't look a day over 30.
Wow.
So I don't know if it's like that in the water, but it was cool. Yeah. Is that weird?
No.
No, it's just,
no, I don't think you get in trouble
for
that.
Clint said that.
I was on the edge of my seat. Yeah.
You were just kidding about that. No, so it's beautiful. And the people, you know, for us, I did an interview the other day, and they said, what do you really love about Australia? And I said, you know what's really cool is when we show up, kids are there at the airport waiting to see us and, you know, wanting to talk to us. So that's really enduring. That's awesome.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I've never been, but everyone raves about it. New Zealand, too.
Yep,
but I don't know if I want to go to New Zealand just because I saw Once Were Warriors and liked it so much. Like, I want to get to New Zealand, too. Everyone
says it's beautiful.
Yeah. And put on an outfit and run around in the jungles and stuff.
Do you see the Maoris and stuff when you're there?
Yeah, we don't get out much today. I don't want to go out in the terrain. I want to get out in that full Australian experience, but, you know, we never get to do that.
Yeah, we never really
just want to lay around.
Do you travel with wives, or is that a no-no? No girls, no wives?
Oh, no, we do travel with wives, but I don't think we'll take them across the pond to Australia this time. It'll be too much money.
Yeah.
Okay.
To be honest, yeah.
You got that seven dust money, though.
It ain't long.
That limo money.
That Uber money. You got Uber money.
Exactly. Oh, no. Seven Dust flying standby? No.
Somebody better reimburse me.
Yeah, you just had another kid, LeJon.
Yeah, it's December 17th, Kingston, LeJon Witherspoon was born. And what an amazing thing.
Congratulations.
Yeah, complete accident. Me and the wife have been trying for about 5 years. And it's kind of one of those things out of mind. We didn't think it was going to happen. And we kind of got her dialed in with her thyroid. And the next thing you know, man, wow, he's hanging out. Mm. Chilling, so it's a blessing.
And your first boy?
Yeah, my first boy. He's peeing all over the place.
Nice,
awesome. Makes you very happy. Yeah.
Oh, he's a little dude.
Florentine just brought his son to Anthrax and Lamb of God last night. Son is 5 years old.
I know. I met him. I hung out with him at Rockfest. What are you talking about?
Yeah, yeah. Great. And we went to Kansas City.
Me and his son watched Tech N9ne together. It's awesome.
Yeah.
I was just talking to Randy from Lamb of God. He told me to tell you guys hello.
Oh, cool. Yeah.
Yeah.
My son loves those. He's like, Seven Dust. He didn't want to go to school today because he wanted to come in to hang with Seven Dust.
Seven Dust going to be there.
Tell him a little buddy.
He's all in already.
Oh, he's
pretty amazing.
Yeah.
Very cool kid.
That's almost negligent, though. You can't leave your kid out of school to bring him to watch Seven Dust in a radio studio.
I know.
It's good you didn't.
I know, yeah. Especially when I went to bed last night. He's mad because we left two songs in The Lamb of God. He wanted to stay. I'm like, look, you got school. You know,
the principal's not going to give him a pass for Lamb of God. Anthrax and Seven Dust.
No,
that's all.
So
right.
you bring children on the road and everything.
Every now and then, if we're close, you know, we won't bring them on. We don't ride like that. We don't have like 30 buses, you know. But I mean, we'll have one every now and then, a couple hours away from our hometown. We'll bring them out for a few shows.
Good question that you asked there, because I remember the first time that we all got together, we had a dream and said, "What would it be like one day to be able to have our kids and our wives and families out on the road and at shows?" And now it's like that, man. You know, sometimes you look in that bunk and our kids are there and you open it up and his son might be in the bunk or my daughter. I mean, what more could you ask for when you have that running around? It's a family affair with us, man. So,
oh, you like it? Okay, you do. Yeah, a lot of people like the road just to get away for a little bit.
No. Yeah, to get some real sleep.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's cool for your kids to see what you guys do, watch from the side of the stage, even for a little bit and stuff, you know.
Give them the big headphones.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. They got
so it happens. So it doesn't blow out their ears. So my kid's like 37 years old, man. He's on the side of the stage. What's up? You're still doing it, yeah.
Your tune is off.
Yeah.
How old are your kids for real, Clint?
What's that?
How old are your kids for real?
Actually, 5 and 3. My little girl's about to turn 3. Yeah, yeah.
All right, so you got young kids as well.
Yeah, yeah.
Congratulations on the Grammy nomination. How cool is that?
What in the world's going on with that, man? Thank you very much for that.
That is awesome.
Who
are you guys up against?
Lamb of God, Slipknot, the band Ghost.
Ghost, yeah.
Right. Ghost, yeah.
And August Burns Red, which I don't know too much about those cats.
I don't know them.
They're a newer band, yeah.
Okay. Well, we go with Seven Dust.
Yeah, you know what? So this is what I say, too, man. At the end of the day, I'm like, you know what? If we don't win the Grammy, at the end of the day, they can never take the nomination away from us. So thank you for...
You guys going to go to your work?
Yeah, we're going to...
It's a nightmare.
Make a weekend of it. The wives are definitely not letting us not go.
When they found out about that, it was all about them talking about what dress they're wearing. I'm like, listen, they're going to see you on the red carpet for about 5 seconds.
You know how much
we're
money?
Walk up like, who is this? Seven Dust.
You guys are going to be the ones on the red carpet. I have that sign, Seven Dust. Like, oh, thanks. And you're going to everyone's going, okay. They're going to look down at their phone instead of taking pictures. I've done that before on a red carpet. Nobody.
Is Justin Bieber behind them?
Do you get nervous? I hate red carpets because my self esteem is justifiably low. And I'm always afraid no one's going to take my picture. Like, I'm not going to have any photographs taken. It's humiliating to walk a red carpet.
I've already thought about that. And should I not make eye contact or just be focused on what I'm doing? You know what I mean? Because if I look over and I don't get the picture taken, I might be weirded out.
You know what the key is? Like, if some guy says, I got a podcast, I do it in my mom's basement, to talk to that guy for 20 minutes. Because then they're like, who is that guy? Wow, he's still talking. So you're actually on the red carpet.
Yep.
You're stalling.
It's like, who you work for? He's like, who gives a fuck records in this case?
Yeah.
This Grammy nomination is going to cost you boys a lot of money with the wives. Oh, boy. Oh, my God.
You do know.
Oh, boy. Brand new everything.
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 Dinners, everything. We'll fly in, I think, Valentine's will be.
Yeah.
And it's around
before.
Valentine's
yes,
Day.
Yes, the 14th, and then we'll be there at the Grammys on the 15th.
So, you are fucked.
Oh, good God, yes.
You're fucked. Hair and makeup, man.
Yeah, and you can't stay at a Days Inn when you're going to the Grammys with the wives. You can't get a... Expedia days in for $89.
Not here?
Yeah, no, you're not.
That's a sweet thought. I got, hey, luckily, I got a very good friend. You guys remember the baseball player James Shields that was with the Royals?
Oh, yeah.
That went to the Padres. Is a good buddy of mine. And him and his family are taking us to the Grammys. So we'll go to San Diego and then go down with them. So he kind of got us all dialed in.
Oh, cool.
So,
oh, okay. Yeah, he just got that huge contract. He'll get you a nice place.
Well, let me borrow some money.
Yeah. He's great, Shields.
Yes, he's a
buddy, a monster, man.
He's been a great bro for a long time, man. Very cool.
You got an announcement too, don't you? I wanted to announce this before you got in here, and they said don't announce their big, huge U.S. headline tour. Let them do it.
There you go.
Let them do it. Well, you're here now, so we can do this, right?
Let's do it. Let's go, man.
Seven Dust announces U.S. headline tour in support of latest release, Kill the Flaw. You guys are going to be everywhere, huh?
Yeah, we're doing, I think it might be 13 headline shows coinciding with all the festivals, including Rockfest, Rocklahoma, all those big...
Range, yeah.
Yeah, so, you know...
Rock in the Range.
Yeah, it'll be fun, and we'll see a lot of the cats that we've toured with for years and years, including on that Trivium and Like a Storm run that we're doing.
Nice. Mm-hmm. Is this your first year doing Rock in the Range?
Nope.
Okay, that's a great festival.
3 years ago.
We've done it a couple times now. But,
you know, they kind of spread it out. You know, they don't want the same band, so it'll be good for us to get back around with this new album.
And you guys have done Ozfest, and right?
Yeah. Oh, good God.
Yeah.
Ozfest 98?
Yeah.
98, Tool,
Slipknot, what am I talking about? It was Limp Bizkit, Megadeth.
Oh, my God. Tool, yeah. I think I remember that
one. The toilet.
When they had the big toilet on the stage.
Wasn't that when Limp Bizkit got booed? They got No. That was,
Lynn Strait from Snot got on
who
stage.
Who got booed?
Well, it was Crazy Town definitely got booed. Papa Roach.
That's
no, they held their own.
They got booed when I saw them in, it was in Jersey.
Well, it was a weird lineup for Ozfest that year. It was like Crazy Town.
Oh, my God, yeah, I remember that. Yeah.
That Linkin Park, I think, had their first record out, and then it was Papa Roach. So it was a lot of the newer bands on there. But
you forgot all about that.
You guys going to go try to see Black Sabbath?
Yeah, I'm going twice in February when they're here.
No way. You got to. I would love to see that, man. Yeah. I saw a video the other night, and they were jamming. Ozzy was doing this.
Yeah, it's their last tour. You got
to
go.
You have to. It's kind of like what else is going on right now? Guns N' Roses?
Yeah. Do you remember Ozzy did the No More Tours tour?
93.
I know.
20 years ago.
Like No More back then.
Yeah. Yeah. But then the next year, the tour shirts say retirement sucks. So it's like fucking, it's such a great way. We're done. And then they just come back the next
year. Sharon's like, get to work.
Right.
What do you think of Guns N' Roses getting back together?
I don't know. What do you think?
I don't know. I mean, how's Axl's voice? That's what I want.
Axl's voice is good.
If his voice is good, then I'm all in.
Axl.
He could still hit some of those notes.
Yes. That's the thing with me, too.
Okay.
Man. I would like to see it, man. It'll be very interesting. And just the whole story behind it, I would like to see how they're going to get along and how long this is going to last.
I saw them 25 years ago in Toronto. That was the only time I saw Guns N' Roses. I got to see them.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Yeah. And guess what? I look at it like this. I don't think it's going to be that big of a problem, because if I was making that much money, I'd be like, man, look, I love you. I hate
let's make it work. We're going to make it work.
Is it all of them, or is it just... I think Slash, Axl, and Duff.
Yeah, most of them. Not doing
three are announced. Axl, Slash, and Duff.
Right.
And no one knows who else is
why
in it
wouldn't
right
Izzy do it? Like, what else? Why not?
He's been kind of private for a long time now,
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
He just grabbed some money and left. I would assume he would do something. He would pop
maybe he'll do some. He does some, like when Axl's version of Guns N' Roses was out, he would just pop up here and there and do a couple shows.
That's
and
what
then,
he'll do.
It's definitely going to be huge, man. It's going to be a
what's his deal? What's Izzy's deal? He was one
of the songwriters. He's got a ton of money, and he just floats around. And
yeah, he was a big part of that. Did he move to Arizona or something?
Something like that. I hear he's like a gypsy. He just goes around. He's got a ton of, and he's done a bunch of solo records. He puts them out right on iTunes, not even through a record label, and he just doesn't give a shit.
He's just fucking enjoying having that money and doing what he wants. That's a great life.
In his own lane, man.
If he made 5% of any of those songs, he's all right.
And then yesterday,
you ever hear Welcome to the Jungle?
I was going to say, welcome to my jungle.
Florentine was telling us that Sammy Hagar wished Eddie Van Halen a happy birthday yesterday.
Oh, really?
So that might be.
And Eddie said, thank you, Sammy.
And Eddie said, thanks back.
Good to hear from you.
Sam, he's got some new show.
Yeah, it's on Access TV. Sammy's got a show.
Yeah, I was hearing about that when he goes and takes the different stars out and they drive and do the things and go to dinner or something. I was hearing about.
Yeah.
Oh, rock stars in cars getting coffee.
And I think the first guy on the show was the bass player, Michael Anthony.
Yeah, Michael.
Oh, yeah, they're pals.
Yeah, how crazy.
They love each other.
Yeah,
crazy. Those two are close.
Uh-huh.
So,
the new Seven Dust tour is going to be with Trivium, which is a great band.
Mm-hmm.
Trivium and Like a Storm.
Great.
And that's going to start. What is it? April 26th, Baton Rouge.
Nice.
Woo!
You guys want to play a couple songs for us?
Well, you know, so I'm like, we're like hanging out with y'all. This is fun,
let's
man.
Just talk, man. We could talk and play.
But, yeah. So listen, we'll do "Thank You," which this song is off our latest album, "Kill the Flaw," and we've never done this acoustically because this album we didn't plan on bringing an acoustic guitar within 1,000 miles of us. But me and Clint, we're gonna try to pull this one off. You know, we don't have a lot of the stuff going on. We don't have the kids, so maybe you guys could be the kids for us.
Yeah, we did like the whole brick on the wall thing. Yeah, so.
But and this is the Grammy-nominated song, too.
So help me to see, give me a chance to come around. All this closure we need, will this embed our soul somehow? On my own, release me now. We know where to go from here. You are the beginning and the end to all of this. So thanks for coming around and pushing my head back to the ground. Thank you for slowing me down. I need to fall back and start it all over. I've been holding on so long, denying what we've done. I've destroyed myself, but I wish you were completely overthrown. On my own, release me now. We know all the answers, here you are. The beginning and the end to all of this. So thanks for coming around and pushing my head back to the ground. Thank you for slowing me down. I need to fall back and start it all over. So thanks for coming around and pushing my head back to the ground. Thank you for slowing me down. I need to fall back and start it all over. Yeah, start it over. Start it over. Yeah, yeah. So thanks for coming around and pushing my head back to the ground. Thank you for slowing me down. I need to fall back and start it all over. So thanks for coming around and pushing my head back to the ground. Thank you for slowing me down. I need to fall back and start it all over.
Yeah.
I felt weird. Awesome. I was a little nervous.
Why were you nervous? Come on.
You guys are watching us.
That's great.
I know. It's a little weird. It's a little weird, right?
We've never done that acoustic. That was weird. I was hanging out. I was like, man. I was riding that bad boy.
Yeah, that should win the Grammy.
That should win
the Grammy right there. Thank you from Seven Dust.
Thank you. I don't even know what I would do if we won that Grammy, but I will tell you this. A friend of mine runs a business, and they just brought out all from the Sprint Center, the Michael Jackson, the Grammy Awards things. So they had to take all the boxes down, and my buddy got a Evel Knievel, Johnny Dare got an Evel Knievel suit, and Jeremy Dixon took down the Michael Jackson and put that in his house. And he said, well, if you win the Grammy, I'll get you the other box that he had his jacket in. And I said, well, if you're gonna make me a box for the Grammy, make sure you make it big enough where I can sit in there with it at my house.
Right. Yeah, that wouldn't be weird at all. Yeah. Sitting there naked, like sweating
with a light on, smoking a cigarette. I'm just kidding. Listening to it.
But it does matter if you want to win, right? Everyone always says, like, I don't care if I win, but you gotta win.
Yeah, everyone wants to win.
Yeah. And then people tell you, oh, the Grammys, that sucks. No, it don't.
I wish we could be that band that's cool. Hell, man, we don't care about it. We actually care about it. We want any kind of leverage we can get.
Yeah, I think you might. I mean, because Slipknot's won a couple times already, so maybe they won't give it to them this time.
Well, you know, and they're nominated for a couple other things.
Right. So maybe they give it to you guys, give them another one. Yeah.
This right here is
spread the love.
Yeah, this is nice. Thank you guys for, you know, supporting us right now.
No problem.
Really cool.
You got Scott Stapp's on your side, too. We saw that, right?
Yeah, we saw that.
He voted for you already. He showed his Grammy ballot.
That's pretty cool. We saw a couple of cats that you would have never thought that were allowed to vote are voting, which is cool.
We had him in here last week, Scott Stapp.
How was that?
Wow.
He's awesome. Great. He was unbelievable.
Awesome.
Yeah. Very cool. Yeah.
Good for him. He's got some stories to tell.
Oh, my God.
His stories are so crazy that I saw after the interview on Twitter, people like, he's got to be making this shit up.
We toured with Creed.
Really?
Back in the day, it was probably for us, man. I still think that was that was a good time for us, man. I mean, it was sold out arenas all around, and it was amazing. We even went to Canada with Creed back in the day. We're still tight with those guys, man.
Yeah. Do you have any trouble ever? Oh, 'cause I know Kiss is notoriously hard to open for. There's certain bands that are just tough. Was there any bands you guys toured with that, like, when you were brand new, where the audience gave you a hard time or no?
Man, we were nervous about opening up for Slayer because Slayer's fans are just, everyone knows Slayer fans are Slayer fan. We did that Tattoo the Earth thing. It was like Slipknot was headlining. But we played right before Slayer, and that, for some reason, had worked, but it was a nerve-wracking experience.
They're like, damn, wait a second. Something's weird. There's a black guy there. What's he doing?
Slayer. There's a couple times it got a little rough, but, you know, for me, what about you?
I don't know, man. I think, you know, because we're country boys, you know, they know we come in, it's no rock star attitude. You know, the same people you meet going up, you see coming down, as far as I'm concerned.
Well, the beauty is I see them eye to eye because I never move.
See, guess what? That's me too, man. I'm on the taller side of 5'7". I'm a liar. Fuck.
That Creed tour, we toured with Creed, and that was the worst, probably, we were like the, like, Satan coming out of the black hole. I mean, they were like, what is
this? Does sound like
we thought we were going to kick all this ass. We're like, we're going to open up for Creed and destroy the stage, and we got out there, and they were like, not impressed, people holding their ears.
Really?
They have a lot of energy on stage, too, so you guys are coming out fucking going crazy.
Oh, we came out all guns blazing.
Yeah.
The next night, we put on button-up shirts the next night and tried to chill our set out a little bit. it was funny. Oh, wow, guys.
I tried to refrain from cussing out the family in the front that was looking at us like we were idiots.
We came out throwing water on people.
I respect that, though. You were trying to win them over.
You were trying to win them over
that first night.
Yeah, oh, my God.
All right, wait, we got to change some things.
Yeah, we were young, man. But you know what?
That's funny.
I would not change anything about those days. We learned so much, and we're still around. You know? We learned the things to do right.
Isn't it weird being a singer? It's always fascinating to me watching the singer when the band is playing. Like, what do you do? Like, with King Diamond, I love. He does this really weird thing where he just kind of, like, strums along with it. He doesn't know what to do. Yeah. It seems so awkward.
Awkward, yeah. I just kind of rock out. I just get into the vibe of the music, man. We've been around so long. It's a joke. Me and Clint, I always say it's like we're Black Jovi. So,
you kind of get it though, right? You get it without having to go.
So you guys are John. You're John and Richie.
Wanted.
Oh, we need a shirt, Black Jovi.
You guys got to play some Bon Jovi for us now.
Oh, God.
Do you know a Bon Jovi song?
Man, I mean, yeah, there That'd was a hilarious. Era where we—that's all we'd listen to. Yeah, man.
Did you ever? I think how much fun it must be to sing. Like, I was watching you sing. Like, it must be so much fun to go. If I want to sing somebody who I like, I can just go up and do it. That must be so awesome.
Man, I don't. You would think it's like that, but a lot of times I don't really like to hear my own voice. If that makes sense. Does that make sense?
I mean, I feel that way about myself. Yeah, and so everyone who listens to the show.
I guess you're your own worst critic, and I've always been that way. I like to sing, but sometimes I'm like,
yeah.
You know, does it sound
good? If I had your voice, I would sing. I would never talk. I would, like, constantly sing everything.
Hello, Clint.
Have you done any, like, tribute albums or stuff like that? There's always these bands that will do a tribute album to somebody.
I did a Michael Jackson tribute album with Bruce Kulick, called me up, and was pretty cool. I think...
What song?
Black and White. But the version I did, you know, I did it in a little studio in Atlanta. I wish I would have definitely gone to California and recorded, but it was fun to do that tribute.
I got
to
hear that song now.
I got to be a part of that. Yeah, it's a little weird, but it was cool to be a part of doing something with Michael Jackson's legacy. So, you know. I worked with Bruce Kulick to call you up, too. It's like, hey, what's up, man? It's awesome, yeah.
I always love those records. Like, when you hear, like, there's one called Nativity in Black where all these bands did Sabbath songs. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Lemmy would always do, he's done Kiss songs and May. I always love fucking when bands tribute.
Yeah, Lemmy does a great version of Breaking the Law.
Oh, it's awesome, yeah.
Yeah. I want to hear that.
Yeah.
Lemmy, rest his soul. Wow. I got a story just to check. I got chill bumps because he's with us. I know it. We played the Barfly in London years and years ago. And this is a small, little bitty dive bar. And I remember being in the dressing room and the actual seat, like a couch, was a truck seat, like a actual bench truck seat, and Lemmy's here from Motorhead to see you guys. I'm like, what? And Lemmy comes in our dressing room and sits down beside me and talks and says, I like your band and don't you ever F this up.
Wow.
And he went on to tell the story about him being a guitar tech for Jimi Hendrix. And from that day on, me and him were tight, like very cool. Lemmy wrote Seven Dust a song on that. Was it the Ozfest thing that we did? Wrote us a song. I remember seeing Lemmy in a pair of Speedos.
Yeah.
And he
don't forget that.
You don't forget that. And he's like, hey, come in my room. And I remember walking behind Lemmy, and he had these Speedos on. I went in his hotel room, and for me as a kid to walk in this little Holiday Inn, and I remember looking to the right and seeing the white boots and all the stuff that he wore on stage. And I'm looking at the stuff, and I want to try this on. He's like, forget about that. Would he have some Hitler stuff in there? Like, you know,
he said, he did.
He said, don't worry about that, man. I said, I'll collect that stuff, man. I'm like, cool, let me try this hat on. This is a true story, man. That guy was a genius and just such a great-hearted man. And I got to see him again in L.A. I went to the Rainbow, and I had my daughter and my wife, and Lemmy, of course, was at the bar because he was getting ready to do a solo thing at the Whiskey that night. Him and his drummer, I think, were there. And sure enough, my daughter came up to him, and he told her how beautiful she was and gave her a big kiss on the cheek, and we hung out. So that was my last time seeing that man.
Yeah, wow. he was a very underrated writer, too, man. Wrote a lot of great stuff.
The hit song, what was the Ozzy song?
Mama, I'm Coming Home.
Are you kidding me? Well, that's the song of our heart. That's the song at the end of the tour.
Yeah.
Yeah, very cool, man.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a shame, man. Definitely. Did you ever drink with him? Do you ever have one of those nights where
at the Rainbow,
Jack and Coke?
Definitely. Without a doubt. That night I had a drink with him. I put my daughter back into the nicer area and had a drink with him that night.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he was known to tip a few back.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Just a couple.
And
just
sitting there at the poker game, he was still doing the same thing at the little poker game at the end of the bar.
And he said, you'll never see me drunk. I'm never staggered. He goes, I just have one long drink. That was his thing. I just have one long drink.
Yeah. I've never heard a bad word from anybody about Lemmy. Like, even privately. Of course, on the air, people wouldn't, but never private. No
Everybody
one
loved
ever
him.
Said a fucking negative word about him.
He was still living in that same apartment complex at right down the street from the Rainbow, and it's right, really pretty much right across the street.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Very cool, man.
That was his joint right there?
Yeah.
He didn't have...
He'd walk right down the hill to the Rainbow.
Big ass house.
Oh no, he's still in that same apartment.
It was a rent control place where he got it like 25 years ago. Whenever he moved,
stayed there.
Yeah,
I think his manager got him a newer place after a while. Really? Like, I think his manager really looked out for him.
Okay, right.
I think that and said, you know, put some money aside so we can get another place. Mm-hmm. So I think he might have.
What a legend, man.
Yeah, absolutely.
And also sad about David Bowie too. So
yeah, did you meet him or no?
No, never met David. Did you ever meet him?
No. I was a huge fan then. Mm-hmm. Especially with the whole Nine Inch Nail connection there. I was reading a cool article with Trent yesterday about that.
Right. You know what I think is amazing about David Bowie is that my daughter loves him to the fact of the show. What was the movie? Labyrinth.
Mm-hmm. They're redoing that.
Yeah, are they really? So when she's like, oh my gosh, she knows his voice from the Labyrinth. So I'm like, this is really interesting that my daughter loves David Bowie just because of that. But now she's more into his music. So that's really cool. You know, his legacy continues with the little kids.
Oh, absolutely.
Who was the coolest guy that you liked that you wound up knew you or liked you? There had to be somebody you met who was actually a fan of yours, but you were surprised at.
What do you think, man?
Man, you've met a lot of people that you were surprised that.
Well, who was a fan of the band that you guys couldn't believe?
Yeah, that's what
I meant. Man, it's, I don't know. It's been a lot of people come out. Man, we got a lot of country guys that come out to hang out with Seven Dust in Nashville. You know, you never know who might pop up. Who do you think?
Man, I don't know. I mean, I think Justin Timberlake or someone new. You know, mentioned LJ. Unlikely. You know?
Yeah, I was at his sound check, our old sound guys, Justin Timberlake's sound engineer, and also now Madonna. So it's kind of cool to hang out with Andy. You know, because he's like on the big thing. Yeah, but the people like that, man. If you hear that, it's amazing.
Justin Timberlake knew you guys.
Oh yeah, because people that work with Justin Timberlake, a few cats like that, a few big cats, man.
Yeah.
The Prince, I would like to meet Prince. That's somebody that now his band, his people in his band like Seven Dust.
I would be nervous as hell to meet Prince, man.
You know what? His guitar player, that's what Justin Timberlake said.
He looked into my soul with his eyes.
listen to what he said. I said, man, I want to meet Prince. He looked at me and said, so if he was right here right now, what would you do? He said, you messed up already. I didn't say anything. He said, you're already coming in too hot. He said, Prince would probably talk to you more if you told him you didn't like something he had on.
Yeah.
I was like, what? He said, you'd probably get his attention more. Because he said, think about like this. He's always been told how much you love him.
Yeah.
His whole life. And I said, well, that makes sense. So he said, just calm down. So when you do see him, just be like, hey, man, I don't like those shoes. He said, he'd probably talk to you.
It is weird because I guess those guys get used to being called a Jew. What can you say that's going to resonate to Prince?
Right.
You're brilliant. You're smart. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, he doesn't hear anything.
Come here,
shit.
Little fella, and you hug him. That would probably work.
Right.
Come
here, little fella.
Yeah, pick him up. Shake him.
Give him a tussle. Tussle his hair.
Yeah, a little kiss on the cheek.
Sure.
He's amazing, too.
You guys want to do another song?
Well, yeah, man, we'll do another one.
Let's do this. Seven Dust in the studio.
Angel Sun.
So we'll do this song.
Which one? Black. Which one?
Angel Sun.
All right.
Nice.
We're going to do Black Angel Sun.
Nice. Good choice.
Yes, Angel Sun, you know, for us, this song, we actually wrote this song about a man. His name was Lynn Strait from the band Snot that we really felt like put us in the focus of, wow, we have to really get on stage and do what the hell we come to do. And that was that band. And Lynn passed away. I think for us in our young lives, that was the first time that kind of came across where someone our age died back then. So when we were asked to write this song, we didn't know what to write. How do you write about something that you've never really experienced? So when we went in the studio, me and Clint had this chorus for Angel Sun. But that day in the studio, I didn't have verses at all. Didn't know what to sing, had no idea, and this song kind of came about just like that. And even on the second verse coming through, didn't have any lyrics at all, and it just kind of came to me. So I felt like that he was there. Not a lot of songs happen that way, but this is one of those kind of songs that was special, and I think that he was definitely on our shoulder with that. And this is Angel Sun.
Left to say one last song given to an angel song. As soon as you were gone, as soon as you were gone.
this came about.
We have a new life now. Our babies live through you. What can I do? I feel so alone now. I would pray for, we still love you. You were fighting every day, so hard to hide the pain. I know you never said goodbye. I had so much left to say. One last song given to an angel son. As soon as you were gone, as soon as you were gone, one last song I can't believe you're gone. Given to an angel's son. Yeah. As soon as you were gone, as soon as you were gone, gone, gone.
Nice. Jeez. Yeah, that's all right, man.
Really great, man.
Seven Dust.
Make me sweat like a bad girl in church.
It's a little warm in here.
It's a little warm, yeah. It's been heating up all morning, so.
Right on, man.
And the tour starts April, what, Jim?
April 26th. Yep. Seven Dust, Trivium, and Like a Storm.
Coming in, knocking down doors.
Yeah, April 26th through May 28th, so about a month on the road in the States.
Yes, sir.
Someone's asking about Texas, so I'm looking real fast for this guy. You going to make Texas on this tour?
Nope, not at all.
Oh, no,
we
Texas.
We always eventually
Big John,
make Texas.
Sorry.
Always, we'll be there.
We can do an entire tour in Texas.
Mm-hmm.
There's a thousand places
we'll,
to play there.
We'll do that, and then we're getting ready to go to Australia. Look at the view. Mm-hmm. Australia? Look at the view.
You remember, yeah, I remember that guy.
Well, man, this was a pleasure, guys.
No, thanks for having us, man. Yeah, we love New York, and thank you guys for inviting us down, man. This is great.
LeJean and Clint of Seven Dust. You got the big tour. You got the Grammy nomination. Yeah. Things are going well. You got a new baby.
Yeah, so
congrats on all this stuff.
Yeah, man, we're doing all right, man.
SevenDust.com. You got your Twitters, too. And it's either Seven Dust on Twitter or LJ Spoon or Clint Lowry Net, and there is an E in Lowry.
Yes. You guys are professional up in here, man.
Oh, we're trying. We know how to get those plugs
Can
out.
Get a job. Man,
we're trying. We're promoting.
Oh, fun.
Hey, how's
we just got plugged, man.
How's Morgan doing,
He's
drummer?
He's a loser. No, everybody's great. No, man. No.
I love Morgan. I love following Morgan on Twitter. He's so angry. It's great.
Oh, my God.
When he wants to get on a flight, he goes, he's Jim Norton if Jim Norton was a drummer of Seven Dust.
Okay, he's an angry one.
Yeah, he's great. I love him.
What is he angry about?
He just bitches. Like
every
like,
airport experience is a nightmare. It's awesome.
It's
never good.
It's never good.
Never good.
Everybody's good, man. Believe it or not, we still love each other and get along, and we've been very blessed to still be the same lineup, man. This is great.
Very good.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a rare thing with a band.
Yes, sir.
To get along 20 years later.
Yes,
yeah.
So and we still want to like hang out. Clint's coming to my house soon.
I know, man. I don't know what's going on with us. We gotta start like getting in like fights and stuff. And
you know what, man? That's a good thing we're still here. So
you're Grammy nominated.
Weird. I hadn't said that yet. And let me tell you something weird.
I'm going to start saying it at Starbucks.
Exactly. Like, you know,
so Grammy nominated on the cup.
What does that mean? Who cares?
Like, who cares?
I tell you what. I thought I started taking it seriously when I did a radio show. And I was like, wow, this is weird. And I had the robot voice, you know, introing us. And it was like, you know, Seven Dust and played all the songs. And hell, LeJean Witherspoon from Kansas. And then the robot voice said, and also Grammy nominated. And I was like,
damn.
It clicked in right there.
Right. That sounds good. With the robot voice.
I like that you admit that it means something, too. That's nice to hear. A lot of guys don't give a shit, and it's like, yeah, it is a nice
It's nice to hear
thing.
The excitement.
I think for the fans only, man. I mean, mm-hmm. That's the main thing, because they've been with us this whole time. It's they can tell people, see, man, they're, you know, now their parents are like, it validates them in this strange way. Like, my in-laws and all these different people are just like, they notice it in a different way. I don't know, man. You've been through as much as we have. Mm-hmm. Anything positive like that, man, we just take take it, you know, for what it is. I mean, we could analyze it and say it's political and do mm-hmm. those different things, but it's just, it's cool, man.
Yeah. I like
you know, it'd be a cool weekend for us to go and do it, you know, and
you
walk
took the
around.
Words right out of my mouth.
Yeah, you know, I mean, whatever. We, you know, it is what it is, man.
It's cool. We feel very blessed to be a part
nice.
Of it.
Nice.
Good right. luck, too, man. You guys are awesome.
Thank yeah. you, man. Yeah.
Now get the hell out of here.
Who's coming in here next? JB Smoove, we have next. And then after JB, we have Jay Williams, who wrote a book called Life Is Not an Accident.
So, oh, right on.
The JB NBA is player. Next.
Yeah.
That had that, you know, he had his whole career in front of him, and then he had that. It was a motorcycle accident, right? Remember him? Jay,
yeah, I know.
Yeah, okay. If you guys want to hang out, you're more than welcome. But Seven Dust, this was great.
Thank you guys.
Again. All right, we'll be back. That was cool with Seven Dust.
Those guys were terrible.
What?
That was really fun, man. I like them. What genuinely nice guys, man. Just really nice dudes.
We're not used to nice guys.
We are nice guys. We deserve to be around nice people.
All right, I like that. I like that attitude.
Yeah. It's not accurate, but it's true.
I was in the bathroom with Clint. I was making him laugh pretty hard because I'm like, now we all have to pee together. It happens all the time. You have these interviews, and then you're in the bathroom peeing next to each other and stuff. And then I told him the story of Tom Jones. We had Tom Jones in here. Oh, you were in the bathroom for that, right, Eric?
No, I was here.
Who was in the bathroom for that? So we have a great interview with Tom Jones. He's open and honest, and it was fun, blah, blah, blah. And then we go to break, and then I'm in the bathroom, and then I see Tom Jones walks. He walks in. He goes into a stall, and he was basically fucking fighting with that toilet for about 10 minutes. And I just stayed in the bathroom until he was done. He was grunting and the noises. He was trying to hustle something out, and it wasn't cooperating. And I'm just thinking to myself, that's Tom Jones in there. He's a fucking legend.
You didn't hear any splash or any of that going on?
It was just grunting, trying to get it out. Yeah, he was hustling. He was trying to hustle one out, and he was struggling a little bit. And I'm like, that's Tom Jones in there. And then other people coming in from this company, and I had to tell him, like, that's Tom Jones.
And you stayed in there just to listen.
You would?
I would have crawled under the stall.
I think I finally gave up because he was really, really having a struggle in there.
So was it a struggle that it wasn't coming out, or was it just kept coming out and more?
No, it was classic, you know, noises, grunting and stuff. And I was giggling like a little fucking schoolgirl. And then I had to let everyone else know that the noises you're hearing is Tom Jones, because that doesn't happen every day.
Are you going to bring that up if he does the show again?
Yeah, I would have no problem bringing that up. Yes. I think he would appreciate it, too, that he's just a man like you and me in the end.
So. I don't know if he'd appreciate that.
Why not?
About his duty on this.
And then you waited in the bathroom like 10 minutes and were telling everyone that came in that's Tom Jones.
I mean, maybe I'm pumping it up for the radio, but it certainly wasn't 10 minutes. But it was more than I needed to be in there.
Yeah.
I'm just kind of, you know, lounging around, and just every noise that was coming from that stall just made me laugh harder. But I was trying not to laugh out loud because that would have been rude.
Imagine explaining that to your son.
What do you mean?
Like, yeah, I waited in the bathroom. This guy was trying to shit, and he was making all these noises.
It's not this guy.
I know, but I'm just saying, and he'd be like, why'd you do that, Dad?
Because it's Tom Jones.
But he'd be like, I don't know who Tom Jones, but even if it was Tom Jones, why would you do that?
Back in the day, because by the time I explain all this to my son, probably no one's going to give a fuck about Tom Jones anymore.
Oh, I don't know. They'll always care about Tom Jones.
You think?
That's just me, yeah.
Mm. But if it's some trucker doing the same thing, I think I would have to hang around and just giggle.
Absolutely.
Okay, so what's the difference? We're simpletons. Men are simpletons in the end. We try to make believe we're highbrow and, you know, intelligent. But in the end, you just want to hear somebody having a tough time in a stall. That just makes your day. Right?
Of course.
We got JB Smoove coming in. Is he here yet?
Not yet. Very close.
Very close? How do you know he's very close?
Roland told me.
His show is huge.
Mm-hmm. He's a really interesting guy, man. His fucking... I can't... I'm only saying people recognize me from it because you think, it's just a show on MSG, but, man, a lot of people watch that show.
And it's a weird show because it doesn't really have a time slot.
But yet it's on all the time.
Yeah, but it can't really have a time slot.
Right.
Because
it's like MASH when the fucking rain delays.
Right.
Like, there's just weird times that go
down. It's just a go-to show on MSG.
You did it this past season, right?
I've done it this one and the one before.
Okay, yeah, I did it this past season for the first time.
Does every city get MSG at this point? How do they get the show elsewhere?
I think on DirecTV.
Okay.
You can get an MSG.
Yeah, because
you have DirecTV anywhere. So
it's huge celebrities.
I was on with Plaxico Burress, Larry Johnson, and somebody else.
How was Plaxico? We had him in here once.
He was great.
Yeah, we loved him. We got to get him back. I forgot. We got to get him back. Maybe we get him back before the Super Bowl. My God.
He's great because he's really outspoken.
Outspoken, very open.
Yeah.
He believes these players are getting fucking hurt.
Well, you just saw that whole thing with the Giants, a Giants safety that was in the last Super Bowl with the Giants.
He was 27
years old.
Dead.
Yeah, and he had CTE on the brain.
He had it as bad as
Junior Seau.
Yes, what is CTE? What's it?
It's the brain trauma
that is caused by concussions.
He was 27 years old. The accidental overdose
of
prescription pills, like in September,
okay.
And the family gave his brain to donate his brain to this place in Boston that goes to the CTE or whatever, and they found out that he had a ton of brain damage at 27. We're playing football for 11 years. He started at 16, I think it was.
Prescription drugs are fucking evil.
He had five concussions, and he was, he's like a backup on the Giants, yeah. With safety or whatever, but he had five concussions in his career and playing for football, and then he eventually got out.
And his brain was damaged.
He couldn't even, supposedly keep down a job when he got out of college and stuff like that. I mean, out of the pros.
Right.
Because he was so unfocused from all of the hits.
Like, a lot of the rules in football, that they've changed a bit to protect players, and people are like, yeah, they're a bunch of fags. It ain't like it used to be. It's like, yeah, but these guys are getting brain damage, you fucking idiot.
It's still pretty.
It's not to be pussies or like, hey, a little fag can't take a hit. It's that they're, they're committing suicide, and they're they're destroyed by the time they're 40. It's like,
the hits are still brutal.
Yeah.
Still.
I mean, for a guy like me, it doesn't matter because I've trained my body.
Right.
Right.
I don't know what they're going to be able to do with that sport.
I don't know, because they say a lot of it starts, they can't even just blame it on the NFL because it starts in high school. It starts in Pop Warner football, the head, just hitting helmets. Practices, like the offensive and defensive linemen, when they're just, in practice, just hitting each other and hitting their helmets and stuff, just do constant hitting and stuff, like just little hits like that just add up.
Yeah.
So they just can't blame it on the NFL. The shit could have happened easily in high school or college.
Absolutely, yeah.
Where damage was done.
And for every player that says, fuck this, because it seems like more and more players are basically saying this, it's not worth it, there's guys just waiting on the sidelines going, well, I'll fucking do this. I'll take this fucking chance.
It's just like smoking. Not everybody's going to get cancer. Somebody could smoke for 30 years and never get cancer. Someone could smoke for 5 and get cancer. You don't know. No, it doesn't affect everyone. Obviously, there's a lot of football players that are living now, 60, 70, and have, had concussions and don't have problems with it. But there are going to be, maybe 3 or 4 out of 10 that it's going to fuck them up. And you don't know if you're going to be that 3 or 4.
And those guys are older, though, so the sport was a little different. The hits maybe weren't as vicious when they were playing.
Well, then they were still as vicious. I think Plaxico is one who's saying that he thinks it's the helmets now that that's
fucking
up.
He said that on our show.
Are they worse?
Yeah.
Why?
Because they're lighter or something.
Yeah, and they were taught to almost use like a weapon, you know, when you're tackling and stuff like that too. Yeah. So
okay,
who do you got in the Super Bowl? You think the Broncos have a shot?
I didn't think the Broncos had a shot with the Patriots. I really thought the Patriots go in there and blow them out because
Brady didn't know what the fuck. I mean, they had Brady's number. My God,
it was unbelievable.
He couldn't get anything done.
New England's their offensive line. They've had they got third string guys in there. They've got a lot of injuries, and they've just somehow just come up with game plans where they can just get rid of the ball quick. But Denver just that defense that they played that day was unbelievable.
Right.
They just beat the shit out of them. It was almost like the Giants Super Bowl, the first one where they hit them so many times.
I think it's going to be a blowout.
I don't know.
Everyone wants to see Peyton Manning win, and that'll be pretty much it for him. It's not happening.
Well,
the Panthers are too fucking tough.
But Denver's got the number one defense in the NFL.
I know, and that does win a lot of Super Bowls in the end, right?
It does. But the Panthers have been blowing teams out, but you never know.
I think it's a blowout. I really do.
I don't know, man. It's like, I've always said, you never know. That's why they play the game. And
you still gotta play the game.
Leave it on the field. I've seen these both teams give 110%. But it is one of those things where it might be a blowout, or maybe it's not. Maybe all of a sudden the one man makes a lot more touchdowns than the other man.
Wow, you know your stuff.
Yeah,
period do you think that they might win?
I don't know.
You think that Denver might, the third period?
The third period, maybe. Third period? I mean, yes, I know that it's a possible hat trick for Camry Newton. That guy's fucking amazing. I mean, he's just, I know I'm not breaking new ground by saying that, but when you watch him, he's just an awesome.
He's really, this year, he's going to get MVP of the league.
I don't think he should.
This wow. year, he really...
I only vote for note pointing to my white skin.
He's quick, too.
He really stepped it up this year. I mean, he was really good.
Way more mobile and now than he's just, Brady,
he's
too.
He's an elite. He's
I don't think the Broncos have a fucking chance in hell.
No, they do with Peyton Manning and that number one defense.
Peyton Manning's not fucking throwing 4 or 5 touchdowns in the Super Bowl this year.
No, their offense is...
There's no fucking way, so you got to hope the defense can hold them.
And the Panthers got a great defense.
Yes, they do.
They got a great defense, but, you know, you can't count Denver out because... Everybody, you know what, in Vegas, I think that there was like, I think 80% of the bets went on New England. Like, Vegas was freaking out that if New England covered that spread against the Broncos, they were going to fucking lose their ass. And everybody was betting on Denver. I mean, on New England, and, you know, Denver pulled that out, so you never know.
I took Denver. I gambled $500 on Denver.
Yeah, I had some teasers on Denver and the Panthers, too.
You didn't bet?
No, yeah, I didn't. I like. I said I gambled $500 on Denver, and no gambler talks that way. Right. You know, I wagered $500.
I don't know. What's the point spread? The line.
But also,
three.
This is Manny's what, third or fourth Super Bowl?
Fourth.
He's
not
been
his first
there.
Day at the rodeo, Jim.
So you know these guys.
Fourth.
Someone going there for the first time. You never know. It was almost like the Mets in the World Series this year. A lot of young guys. Kansas City was there the year before, kicked their ass. Mets will come back this year, maybe go to the World Series.
First guy to be there with four different coaches.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And both coaches in the Super Bowl replaced John Fox.
Oh.
Got fired for both coaches. Okay, then. Nothing about Abe Vigoda, though.
He's not dead.
No.
That's like, that's an old gag.
I will say this. I wish they were saying Abe Vigoda and Eric Stengel right now.
Why?
I didn't mean it.
Because we don't do sports nerd stuff on this show.
I didn't mean it.
It's interesting.
To who?
Me.
Oh. Abe Vigoda's not dead. I mean, they've been doing this thing for years. It's stupid. Every 2 years, they kill him off, and people are like, oh, he's actually alive.
Dude, he looked exactly the same in The Godfather as he did recently. I met him once.
You met him? How was he?
He was very...
It was a
very lovely man, a very brief meeting.
Yeah.
At a roast...
Mm-hmm.
And what a good sport! And
I hope to meet him someday. Because
I wish you'd meet him soon.
I hear he's a lovely man.
And, yeah, he was sweet man.
Before he dies, I would love to fucking meet him.
He's dead.
He's not dead. They do this all the fucking time. You're gonna buy into this crap.
His family's grieving.
How old was he?
95.
95.
Passed away. Yeah.
You know Barney Miller. Obviously.
Linden.
The Barney Miller Show.
Yeah.
Fish. You know he was 52?
Isn't that...
He looked like he was 80. JB Smoove just fucking walks in like that?
That's how I do, baby.
JB, hello.
I thought I was going to give you a big intro or something.
I'm not coming through a trap up door.
Can I ask you something on a personal level? I got to ask you something on a personal level that's not that bad. I think I see you walking around almost every day at the same fucking time. Yeah. I'm going to say Broadway. I'm going to say a little uptown, but not too far uptown.
Mm-hmm.
Am I right?
You do.
Why
not? Life has a schedule.
I just don't want to say hi to you because you look like a guy that doesn't want to be bothered.
JB's delightful.
You know what? I do want to be bothered.
And you do.
I'm a common man.
Yes, you are.
I'm in reach with the common man. The common man loves me because I'm real with it.
Yeah.
I can communicate with them.
I can see. Yeah. Sorry.
The pressure on their brain.
Yeah.
I can see what they're going through in life. Some guys I could tell the lady get on their nerves.
Yeah.
Some guys lost their job.
Right.
Some people just need a pat on the back.
Yes.
Or kicking their ass, one or the other.
Yeah.
And you sense what it is they need.
Jim.
And what do you think Opie needs when you see
know,
him?
He doesn't see me. I see him.
I can mentally kick somebody in the ass.
You understand?
like through my brain waves, kick them in the ass. You understand?
Absolutely. You've done it to me.
Sometimes I need it.
I love your question, but trust me. I see him. He doesn't see me.
Like telepathically kicked in the ass.
Right.
You know what I mean?
So, JB, he sees you every day. Have you noticed him walking by?
Of course he doesn't notice me. I got a stroller, though. Maybe you remember walking by a guy with a stroller.
Ah, in New York? Rare.
No, I see all the time, and I'm like, maybe one of these days I should say hi to the guy.
I'm very observant. I do, but I can sense the bullshit. like I get this little sixth sense.
He's the
I got a seventh sense.
Seventh.
Yes.
You're the best. He's the best dressed guy on the fucking sidewalk every day, though. Every fucking
day. I'm gonna be honest. I'm gonna be really honest right now and blunt. Like, you came at me earlier, something really personal. Like, you know,
yeah.
Y'all need to get y'all shit together. I'm gonna be honest. You guys need to get it together.
Why?
That's a mess in here, man.
We're not a mess.
It's a mess.
It's a messy area.
It's messy, but we're not a mess. Yeah.
Jimmy's a very neat guy, and he appreciates neatness.
You got some of that OCD? You got some of that OCD in there, Jimmy?
You mean a mess like paper-wise, or you're talking about the way we dress?
Just a mess.
In everything.
I always tell people, man, let me rub off on you. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like, physically, let me rub my body off.
We're not doing a TV show, so we come in here in our pajamas, basically.
Man, I understand, man.
All right.
But see, don't be offended by this now. You guys look okay. But there is a term that's called radio face. You do know that, right?
So you're implying that
we look good. That's real, right?
We radio face. We look good for radio, but not for...
Fuck face. Radio face.
We're not ready for TV, though.
No, man.
Jimmy, are you saying you don't like my shirt that I've had from Kohl's for the last 5 years? Because I've had, and it still fits.
That's a Kohl's shirt?
Yeah, it's Kohl's, yeah.
Beautiful.
You're wearing $12 from a company that doesn't even exist anymore. Kohl's, you know what I mean? They leave. Like, you know, big department stores leave certain cities. And they don't come back.
That's a problem.
You got them like you got an Alexander shirt on. From Alexander's?
That's a problem. That store's gone out of business. That's a problem.
Went out of business twice. I got this.
Oh, man. JB, I love your show. I watch it all the time, but the weird thing is what I learned today, you can't fucking find it on MSG because it doesn't have a time slot.
Don't worry. Don't worry.
But it's always on.
It's always on. It's going to be on. These guys did the show. These guys were amazing on the show.
Yeah.
People, I've said before, so many people have seen me on that show. I almost more than anything else I've done, people are like, I saw you on that show with JB. I can't tell you how many people fucking watch that.
People love the show, man. The premiere show last night was great. Chris killed them, as usual. So fun, man.
Did you get Chris, was it taped ahead of the Oscar stuff? Or?
Yeah, we taped it.
A long time ago.
Would have been great.
Would have been great. Would
have been great, though. But even though he didn't talk about the Oscars, you sense the something coming. You know, you sense that he was going to be involved in something really amazing. He's always on the edge of something.
And you said in the press that, you know, you don't want him to step down. He's the perfect comic for this controversy.
Why not, man? I love him, man. I think what he brings to any stage, he can bring to the Oscars,
right,
which I find to be totally amazing. Like my hat, man.
It does look good.
Trying to adjust my coolness.
You're really trying to look really cool right now. I know.
I hate earphones. I'm not an earphones guy. Is it okay?
You don't need them.
No dumbass earphones, man.
What do you think about the whole? Do you think there's any merit to like guys like Will Smith or whatever not going, or do you think that it's like, hey, man, the odds of winning are astronomically low anyway?
I always say, you got to start something to end something, and why not? You know, I think he is the perfect person. Mm-hmm. You know, some things happen for a reason. This happened for a reason that he was in line. He was the guy that's supposed to be hosting the Oscars. If, you know what? Let's think about this. Anybody could have been, you know, the host this year. But would it have the same impact?
Mm-hmm.
You know, we all know Chris. He's like the smartest, one of the smartest comedians out there. He's fast. He's witty. He has all the attributes that we need for someone to make, at least awareness and change something. You know, if something's wrong, I think he's the guy to put a spin on it, make it funny, make it relevant, and be honest about it.
He's perfect. The people that want him to step down don't understand Chris Rock. This was made for him.
This is a perfect platform to be on.
Yes.
What's bigger than this next? Super Bowl, that's it.
Mm-hmm.
The big game, that's about the only thing that's going to top Oscars.
And they're looking for a boycott, but I think the numbers are going to be pretty damn good because of the controversy.
Because of Chris.
It's going to be because of
Chris Rock.
People can not wait
to see what he has to say.
Any of his specials, you know this dude can take anything and make it right and make it, you know, he going to put his own spin on it.
Yeah.
Which I think he should, man. And that's being a professional. But you gotta realize, it's still Oscars. He's gonna be as professional as possible, but at the same time, he's gonna be Chris. That's why they asked him to do it.
Do you think there's a real problem in Hollywood with the Oscars?
I think there's a problem with a lot of things. You know, this is just this is the times we live in right now. And for us being comedians, this is our time. You know, we're losing our voice slowly but surely. And, you know, we're still the ones that are the first wave of news, to my point of view. Because the real news, then you got our news. We take the news, and we change the news around to make it more manageable. Mm-hmm. You know, we'll take the real news and spin it to the point where it can be a horrible incident. But we'll take it, and we'll make it relevant and make it funny. But at the same time, being sensitive, we'll find a way to make it make sense,
yeah, sure.
You know, to the common. Because some people don't like the real news.
No one likes the real news.
People,
who likes the real news?
Some people stop watching the real news because the real news oppresses people. And it's like, damn, what else happened? Jeez.
Mm-hmm.
But they'll go to a comedy club and hear the news like, really, that happened? That didn't really happen. You know what I mean? And right. A comedian will take it and make it a little more better to swallow. Like, okay. And that's what, you know.
24-hour news cycles is one of the worst things that hit our society ever. Because they have to fill all that time up. So they just find anything they can. If it leads, it bleeds, as they like to say.
I'm waiting for the day when I see a news dude, a tear just come out his damn face right. While he's giving you the news. Yeah. And reading the paper, like, this really happened? Damn. What's the world coming to? I can't do this job no fucking more. Enough! There's enough!
Well, they could use a little human emotion, because they tell this stuff like it's no big deal to them.
It's a great point.
Yeah, I would like them to show that they're actually bothered by this. Yes,
the sensitive news, like the news dude is just like rubbing his eyes, his eyes all red on camera, like
emo news.
This guy should not be doing this job. You can't show emotion to anything. You know,
three people were killed.
I can't believe this. It's horrible.
Have you had any of these politicians on your show yet? Any of the guys?
Last night, Chris Cuomo.
Okay.
Cuomo's awesome, man. I love anyone with a political voice or, you know, I think that's amazing. I'm waiting to get some people up there.
Yeah.
Some more. There's a lot of people who I've been trying to reach. But you know how it is, man. You know, some people I call last minute because I had no choice.
Mm-hmm.
You know how it gets. People cancel out. You want to make the table as interesting as possible, you know, when you're doing the show for courses. So, you know.
That's how I got a call at 6:45 from JB. He's like, what are you doing in 20 minutes? I'm like, why, did someone cancel? He's like, no, we had you booked.
Yeah, same thing happened with me. It was my old manager. He's like, look, you owe me a favor, motherfucker. You left me. Be here in 10 minutes.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
That's nice.
But it's one of those things where it's like, but there's a lot of people I could have called. Still. But I still have to make the table like interesting. I need to put somebody in there who I know is reliable, and not just, you know, schedule wise, but reliable as far as their content and what they can
bring.
It's like
a puzzle. You go, if I got this guy, then I need to bounce it out with maybe someone a little funnier over here.
You have to.
Yeah.
Such a good mix of people.
I love it.
I've told the story that the episode I did last year was a lot of us. I was on with Todd Barry and Gilbert and Jerry Cooney and Neil deGrasse Tyson.
That's a great
show,
table.
You know, no knocking the other shows, but probably the best show for that season, easily.
And Neil Tyson is amazing. He, like, boxers are always the most interesting guy in the room, but he was the alpha guy at the...
Oh my gosh.
There's something about a guy that smart that turns everybody into a fucking 8-year-old.
And we started asking questions that only, like, the dude at home would ask. One, is a zombie apocalypse possible? That's one thing we talked about.
Yeah.
Temporary time travel, that means go back 2 minutes after you've done some crazy shit. Like... And the other one was dinosaurs. Like, every dude want to know the dinosaurs.
Yes.
You know?
Yeah.
You know, how did that happen? You know, we try to really break it down. We put him on the spot, though.
He explains things perfectly. It bothers me.
Oh.
You ask a question, and then his explanation is perfect every time. Every word is perfect.
You try to throw him. You try to throw him a loop. Like, maybe you'll lose him a little bit. You know, with some real dumb stuff. You know, like... Let me dumb him down a little bit, see if I can lose him a little bit.
Right.
He can put a science spin on anything.
I love him.
On you walking. He talked about how you can miss a field goal because the earth is rotating at a certain rate of speed. After you kick the ball, if it's a long enough kick, the earth is really slightly moved, still turning.
Come on.
And the ball can lose its trajectory and go and just, if you're off a little bit, that little turn of the earth can make it hit the goalpost.
Yeah, but that's any field goal over 11 miles.
I'm saying, really, is that?
He probably went home that night and laughed like, I got him.
Yeah.
he believed me on that one.
When I pulled out the zombie apocalypse, that, you know, I thought I would lose him. You know what I mean?
Right.
Because every guy wants to know, is it possible that it could happen?
If I was that smart, I would just make shit up and then laugh on the way home on the subway like, ah, those idiots believe that stupid thing.
If you go deep enough, man, and this dude is deep.
He's great. For real, he's great.
He really applied, no matter what we talked about. I said, like, have something to drink. Do you know that the drink that you're drinking? I'm like, Jesus, man.
I just want a refill.
God damn, really?
But such a not-a-typical,
you know, as everyone knows, heavyweight, like, wrestler in college, just a gigantic fucking strong guy. And guys that big are never, you just spilled coffee on your hand. It brought me great joy.
With that kind of power, though, man, you can talk. He just starts talking. He could just break down the contents of panties, and next thing you know, your lady's naked. You know, it's like, how the fuck did this happen just now?
JB, let me ask you this. So, you know, we've had Neil deGrasse, and that's a no-brainer. When he comes in, we know it's going to be great. Has anybody surprised you where you're like, wow, I didn't know this guy was so deep or this interesting?
No, it's some real...
Like, who surprised
alone,
you?
No, it was really smart. Charles Smith. Former Nick.
Yeah.
This guy is smart, really smart. He was so smart that George Wallace shut the fuck up. Like, George Wallace was like, man, this guy really smart right here. You know, George is very outspoken.
Yeah.
George almost relaxed a minute and was like really like into what Charles was talking about.
What was he talking about?
Yeah, everything. He covered the Knicks, his Nick life. He covered hanging with Dennis Rodman over in Korea, which had to be an adventure.
Yeah.
I mean,
he was with him when he met Kim Jong-un.
Yes.
He was part of that team.
Oh.
He was one of the guys who went, what the fuck did we get ourselves into? Did you remember that press conference when Dennis Rodman was babbling and the players he brought with him, they're like, oh, my fuck. I hope we get out of here alive.
Yeah.
He went in. Let me tell you something. It's a great episode.
Yeah, I can't wait to see it.
When is that? Was that next week?
You know what? I don't know the order of shows, but stay tuned because that's a good one.
Yeah.
He really, 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 really went in, you know.
What did he say about North Korea? Did he have anything?
Man, I don't remember everything about it, but I do remember him talking about being around Dennis, being around in that situation. I realized there was a lot going on when they went over there. So it's like they had to explain everything, and you start to wonder to yourself, like, okay, you know, I know I'm over here to play basketball, but this is way bigger than basketball. It's become way bigger than basketball. Even if you didn't intend for it to be more than just about basketball and pulling the countries together, but it becomes way more than that because of the situations that were going on at that time.
Yeah.
So and you're rolling with Dennis Rodman.
Right.
You know what I mean? And he's slightly inebriated in the damn press conference. You could tell, like, something's not right here.
They weren't happy.
Somebody had a few shots before this press conference.
Can you see the screen? We got a screen cap of the press conference. You can just see it on their faces. They're like, oh, my God.
They're like, oh, no. Why is this idiot talking? Man, this is live TV.
And look at Charles Smith. Charles Smith is right there like, he didn't mean that.
Let me reiterate what he was
trying. Let me jump in here because
let me reiterate. Right.
And it's got to be scary meeting a guy like that because he's the dictator and you don't know if you're going to say anything that is taken as a slight or is lost in translation or is considered rude. Like,
tell you something, man. I don't even trust going to Jamaica, let alone if I go on vacation, man, I go with caution. You know, I don't play around.
I thought you were talking about Jamaica Station.
Hey, I don't give a damn.
When those doors open up in Jamaica when you're trying to take a train out to Long Island.
Wow. I look around real good.
When they open those doors, you don't know this. You're not a Long Island guy.
No.
It stops in Jamaica and
it's bad.
You just want those doors to shut again quickly. Sorry, hey man.
Anywhere.
It might be a white boy thing.
I don't know.
It might be a white boy thing.
I'm on vacation.
Yeah.
With caution, brother. I don't play around. I read the local paper. I don't play around.
Where do you like to go on vacation?
I'm going to keep it real, brother.
Poconos?
I might be the whitest black dude you ever met in your life.
Then the Poconos.
No, I'm not a Poconos guy. Hey, I went to the Hamptons for the first time over the summer.
How was it?
I live in New York. It was great, man. Did a little show up there at the theater out there. It was really nice. Mm. You know what I do, man? I'm going to be honest. I'm an RV dude. A lot of people don't know this, but I like to hike. I got a big-ass RV. All my friends will tell you, man, I throw the best beach parties you ever seen in your life. A lot of black people don't do the beach that much. I'm a beach dude. I camp out. My RV out. Invite all my friends to the RV.
Nice.
I grill. Drink wine. Hanging out. I'm real low-key, brother. Believe me. I know I look sharp and look snazzy all the damn time. Like I've been a world traveler.
We were saying that.
But I'm like a world traveler in my mind. I'm a world traveler.
Yeah.
But I keep it real simple, bro. I'm trying to tell you, man.
You don't mind being outdoors and camping and shitting outdoors?
No. You misunderstood me. I said, I got an RV.
Oh, yeah, okay.
With a door lock.
Okay.
And all that good stuff.
I would love to drive around in an RV.
A tent ain't gonna happen.
Okay, good.
No, I go to RV resorts.
Right.
You know, I pull in, the gate closed behind me, the guard in a little golf cart drives me to my little space, I back my RV up, I park it, you know, I hook all my stuff up, and it's party time.
Oh.
I get back in it, fold everything back up, and drive through the gate, and back to my house. There is no pitching a tent. None of that shit.
So how big is your RV?
I don't think that's you guys.
But you don't sleep over. You just go for the day?
I stay for about a week sometime.
Gotcha.
Yeah, I'm on vacation.
How big is the RV?
It's an A-class, like a 38-footer.
Damn.
So how many beds are in it that could sleep in?
Sleeps 10 people.
Damn, really?
Sleeps 10 people.
Wow.
Can you shit in the RV?
Shit.
I thought that was a no-no.
Shit, fuck, anything, man. Anything you want in an RV. It's a goddamn rolling house.
We talked to these rock stars. It's a no-no to shit on the bus.
I can sleep 10 people.
Yeah?
I could charge rent and have roommates and shit if I wanted to.
Do you drive it or do you have someone drive it?
I drive my own shit.
So you had to get a special license?
No.
No?
Over 40, I think over 42.
Oh.
I have a certain license. So I just got under so I can drive that bad boy.
How hard is it to drive?
No harder than driving a city bus and shit.
That seems hard.
Those guys manage pretty well.
Yeah,
it's amazing what the city bus driver can do.
Like a good living. It's about as big as a city bus, basically. Shit.
Man,
how far is it? Bathroom.
What's the style? What's it? I want to see what this looks like. What is it? What kind of RV is it?
Mine is called a Damon Outlaw,
which is
also a toy hauler. What we do is. We bought a little smart car. Because the smart car goes inside, you know, inside the goddamn, inside the RV. The back folds down like a ramp in the back. It folds down. The ramp hits the ground. You pull your smart car into the back of it. Close it up. Or you can put motorcycles. Or you can put, ATVs or whatever you want inside.
That's how big. That's a small smart car.
There
wow.
There's pretty much his ride.
But you're losing
a version of it.
You're losing living space though. You're losing half the living space with the car.
It still sleeps 10.
Cool about it. That's only a toy hauler. That back part. What happens? In my back part right there. I got a TV in that shit. I got everything I need inside the back part. Air, TV, radio, all the good stuff. So when you close that back part up, the smart car out. Close it up. You put a bed back there, and you got another extra bedroom.
But why bring the car if you already have the RV?
Because when you get to a RV resort, you want to be able to go out and enjoy yourself. I go to Vegas in my RV. I'll park at the RV resort, and I can drive to Vegas and park my car, my little smart car, and go and gamble, have a good-ass time. Drive back to the RV resort, you know, and park the car. And I'm good. See right there?
How far is the RV?
See how that shit is?
How far is the car
is just the same size as the goddamn golf cart, damn near.
How far is the resort from the casinos?
There's plenty of good ones. The resorts are normally in a nice location. It's lit up. It's really nice. 10-minute ride to the strip. Perfect.
Yeah, that's awesome.
See,
good for
I can have a balance of black people shit and white people shit at the same time. You got to balance your life out a little
bit. That's right. He's at an RV resort.
You do some black shit once
but he
in a
gambles
while.
At Circus.
No, you save so much money. I'm telling you, those RV resorts are amazing. Like 3 pools, tennis court, golf course, everything for like 10% of what you would pay at a hotel.
Mm.
And I can leave when the hell I want to leave. I can check out when I fucking want to check out.
There's some at the beach too, like right on the beach. You can.
I go to the beach constantly all summer. I go to the beach park. 40 people show up. They bring meat and snacks and shit like that and wine. We cook that shit.
Nice.
And we cook that shit.
That's
why I pour the wine on top of the meat.
Best. Where's the farthest you've driven this thing?
34 hours.
To where? From where to where?
Nashville.
Okay.
Manchester, Tennessee, matter of fact, to Bonnaroo. You been to Bonnaroo?
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, that's some white people shit.
Yeah, it is.
Huh?
Yes, it is.
There's a few black artists in there, but some white people shit. You know? Porta potties every goddamn way, people drunk. Every year, somebody died, that motherfucker.
I don't know why we're laughing at that much.
It's not funny. But you hear about it while you're there. Right. But you keep on having a good fucking time, though.
You just try to ignore that someone
that's
died.
That's some shit right there. Yeah.
So you go to Bonnaroo.
Yeah, yeah, rock on. What the fuck happened? What?
You park right at the venue.
Yeah. You get VIP parking at the big
Well, you're festivals. JB, though.
Goddamn right. Now, I'm not saying everybody can park there.
They got a spot for your RV every
not
time.
Not for every fucking body. It's for certain people.
Sure.
Call early.
Yeah.
JB showing up.
Yeah.
Open that gate.
Yeah.
You put a little tag on your windshield. Where I park at, you know?
Nice.
But, see, when you park at these big, you know, big festivals, you gotta limit your bathroom privileges. You gotta limit it. You know, because you got your tank on your hose a certain amount of shit. You know what I'm saying? I'm being blunt. You just hold a certain amount of shit. So you got a limit. You know, you go and visit other people in RVs, use their bathroom. You know what I'm saying?
You time out your
shit. You're pissing shit out.
You time out your shit.
How many days?
So you don't fill your own thing up, and you gotta pull it out. You got to go to a dumping station. You don't keep going to dumping stations all the goddamn time.
How many days can you shit in it before you have to go to a dumping station?
Depends how much food you eat. Now, you eat peanuts and snacks and granola and that kind of shit, it'll go a long way. But if you a steak and potatoes dude, you got a big problem. Then you go to someone else's RV and shit it up, brother.
And you shit your brains out.
Shit the big food up. You know what I mean?
There's JB entering
you
his shitter
yours
again.
For the granola and that little stuff, little snacks, little fruits and stuff.
But when you're at the RV park, they have a system right there for you, so it's not a big issue.
At the RV park, you have all the hookups.
Right.
But you go to these big-ass, you know, 40-acre fields, you know, like Woodstock. You know, you go up there, you gotta move it.
How far is the dumping station normally from where you're going? Like, how do you know where one is?
And do you have to...
But here's the thing, you can't do this, though. You can also call, and they'll come, and they'll dump it for you. They'll bring a big truck and do it for you. You just gotta make sure you're around. Yeah. You know, you gotta wait for them. You know, and sometimes you'll do a bunch of, you gotta wait and half your day, you miss somebody in concert fucking around. You know? Or,
I hear you.
I said, you can go to somebody else's trailer and shit in their trailer.
Have you done that?
Saving time for yourself.
Have you shit in somebody's?
You goddamn right I do. I'm organized, brother. When I get there, the first thing I do is make friends with everybody who parked near me, get real good with them. No, I mean, they don't know I'm going to shit their bathroom up. Tell them I'm going to shit their bathroom up.
That's the only reason you're saying
You be friends. You befriend them. You make friends. Yeah. It's all scheduling, though.
So
you have to understand how to schedule your time and how you're going to maneuver and make this work for you at this festival.
So you get excited when someone recognizes you as JB Smooth, and the one thing you're thinking is, I'm going to be shitting in their RV.
In my mind, I'm thinking, oh, I'm going to shit that bathroom up good. I'm going to tell you something.
And you know they're going back
they
to
don't
that.
Know, I mean, they don't know that. I'm not going to let them know that. But, again, yeah. I also recognize when other RVers are thinking like me, trying to shit in my bathroom. You understand? I understand. What's the game? I know the game.
You don't allow it.
Hell, you can't come in my RV. And as soon as they say, oh, I'm sure you don't have company, you're JB Smooth. I said, you goddamn right. And my mom said, you goddamn right. I said, oh, I'll brush it off. Like, oh, no, don't worry about that, man. Yeah.
So, JB, let's say
I'm not getting in my RV.
Let's say I'm in the RV next to you and I come over to yours. Then I go, hey, can I use your bathroom? What do you say?
I'm going to say, ha, 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 ha. Where you park at, man? I'm going to say, where you park at? I'm going to say, you know what, man? I'm almost at capacity. That's what I use. Which is a common phrase used amongst RVers. I'm almost at capacity. Because in the RV, there's a panel. You press the buttons and it'll tell you what's full. You know, you have your fresh water. It's like it's called black water, gray water, fresh water. You know, and tanks. It'll tell you everything you have. Mm. So the black water meaning the dirty water. Black water is shit water, piss water. The gray water is washing dishes, washing your hands water. So they go into different tanks.
Gotcha.
And it'll say, you press the button, it'll tell you how much you have to go. You know, it'll say like you're 3/4 full in your tank, your dirty tank. Now, you know when it's three quarters full, you don't got another quarter left of shitting to do. So you got to be very careful and limit. That's when I look. I check my gauges and say, okay, I may have another 4 or 5 dumps I could do with this motherfucker. Give or take. That's when I make my move.
So the whole
that's argument. When I make my move and start work. I worked a lot, you know. I worked a lot.
So what we're learning here is the whole RV world is a shit game. It's just a shit game. That's all this
it is. It is what it is.
There's
brother.
No luxury.
Because especially when he says
no
you have
leisure.
To, you have to wait for the guy to right, come and it, ruin right. your whole day.
Now you have an apartment right now, right?
Yes, I do.
Now imagine. Picture in your head right now. Yeah. Take your place you live at, right?
Okay.
Just picture in your brain.
Yeah.
Close your eyes right now.
Ooh, thank
now,
you.
Close your eyes. Now, imagine the place you live in right now
yeah.
with wheels on that motherfucker. Nice.
I hear you.
Everything you do at home, you do in that RV.
Right.
You get up in the morning. Your morning piss, your morning shit, right? Mm-hmm. Aha! Every day, that gotta happen in that RV. One way or another, is in your RV or the man next to you's RV. Sometimes you spend the night just a shit in somebody's house. Oh, I must have dozed off. Oh, what time is it? Oh, man. Oh, man. And they'll say, all right, relax, man. It's all good, man. It's all good.
Yeah.
And so that's when you go, yeah, it is all good. I'm about to shit in your bathroom.
It's just all about shitting.
I got you. I'm just saying.
They're not relaxing at all.
There's modern conveniences that you need when you are traveling in an RV, which it does save time. When you're driving across country, you don't want to stop in these damn dirty ass bathrooms and these gas stations. When you stop, that's when you become a victim of bullshit. Every time you stop in another place that you don't recognize, you're driving across country. When you fucking stop, you open yourself up to other people who are committing bullshit along the path to where the hell you gotta go at. You want to stop the least amount of times when you are traveling. You pee in a bottle. How many times have you been driving in a show? You said, fuck that. We comedian. We piss in a bottle in a heartbeat.
It's tough to do, though.
I just did it last night.
It's you will piss in a bottle. If you don't want to stop.
Of course.
Jeez. You will piss in a bottle in a heartbeat.
JB, you could catch one of your friends if he went in there shit because you can go check the tank afterwards.
I can check the tank.
He goes in the bathroom and goes, I didn't shit. You go, watch. And you
watch
hit
this.
That button.
What's that we did?
Yeah.
I got 0.2 left in my goddamn tank. And that's accurate numbers. 0.2.
I love them. What's up with that? What's up with that? The level was here,
man.
Now it's up
you
here. What's
shit
up
in
with
my
that?
Bathroom. Right. I tell you no shitting in my bathroom.
How long does it take you to fill it up? When you got to get gas, you have to stop for gas. There's probably a lot of gas stops.
Oh, my fucking God. The goddamn gas.
How much to fill it up?
Jesus.
It's cheap now,
like
though.
This. You know the gas.
It's cheap now, James.
His only way I can. I gotta do. You gotta do math when you're putting gas on the RV because, you know when you get gas nowadays, it only goes to $99. It'll stop at $99. You can't just go, you know, and put $500 of gas in your RV. You can't do it. It's gonna stop at $99. Put the credit card back in there again. I got put like this. I can put the credit card in there at least 4 or 5 times.
Wow.
At least. But the range. I can fucking drive forever.
How many miles is it? How many gallons is it?
Shit. It's like a 100 gallon tank or some shit like that.
And then how many miles to a gallon you get?
Two.
With all that shit in there, it's
2 miles.
Don't shit. We're trying to get 12 miles to a gallon.
The mileage is not great. But here's what you do.
My RV's heavy.
You get the RV. You drive it one time. You see how that shit feels.
Yeah.
Right? You gotta drive. You gotta be able to drive this RV like you drive. So when I got mine, I went to Vegas, tested it out a little bit, you know, see how I like it, how I'm feeling it. Here's what I did. I took it right back to the dealer. I said, "Yo, I need some more power." So he put a performance kit in the damn RV. I said, "I want to be able to pass people." Cause you know what? I want to drive this goddamn big ass fucking monster like I drive my regular car. So I said, you know what? I want a performance kit put in it, put a little chip in there, put a little exhaust system in there. So I upgraded everything so I can be able to go, your slow ass. I'm going around your slow ass. You know what I mean? That's how I do it.
So you bought it new?
I bought it brand new and upgraded everything in it so that you can drive it how you want to drive it, which means I save gas, you know, and you put the performance kit up there to save gas to make it so you can drive how you want to drive it. And I got better gas mileage. I can drive my ass off. I can drive far as shit in that damn thing.
Nice.
So I got the power and I got the economy with the system I put it in.
What's the biggest one you could have gotten? You went with 38 feet.
Shit, man. There's some big ass ones, man.
They go, what
mine
they
ain't with? Shit. I pull into RV resorts. I look like a fucking, I look like I'm some entry level shit.
Oh.
No, they got some joints with marble floors. Like, I go to RV shows too. I went to an RV show. This dude said this one right here is $600,000, but I got one for $1.5 at my dealership that'll blow your mind. I said that's about all it's going to do is blow my goddamn mind. Cause my shit costs $150. I'm good. And I got everything you got in that motherfucker right here, except the marble floors.
Well, go down a little. What the fuck is that?
I don't know.
The LMMN? Element.
Shit.
That looks like a yacht on wheels, doesn't it?
No, these RVs are no joke, man. No, they are no
joke. I've never seen anything like that before.
I promise you, man. This is
two stories. Two stories.
That's the life. I'm telling you. A lot of you guys are going to end up buying them.
But is that hard to. But are there limits where you can go with that? Because obviously, how do you know the height limit?
That's another thing. That's another goddamn thing. So, which is a major problem for new RVers. You have to know your fucking height. If you do not know your height in your mind, you will fuck up. You will fuck your RV up. I promise you. You will fuck your RV up, man. I promise you will fuck that RV up first week. Your ass think. If you fucking think you're going to live on a McDonald's diet in a fucking RV, you got another thing coming. I'm telling you, you will rip the whole roof of that motherfucker off pulling into a goddamn McDonald's drive-thru. You will fuck up your RV and fuck McDonald's up. They got to tow you and McDonald's away. You will fuck McDonald's up, I swear to God. You got to know your height, because I'm telling you, you cannot pull into a... You got to park it and walk your ass inside and get the food, because you try to turn that big-ass damn thing, be lazy, and turn that big-ass fucking monster to that drive-thru.
You're losing the top.
How about
you
now...
You save the whole top of that shit off.
But how about, like, highways and stuff? Aren't there certain... Or is that only, like, in Long Island?
Look, you stay on highways, you stay off routes. Parkway. Don't get on parkways.
No.
You'll tear that whole roof of that shit off. I promise you, man. You seen these 18-wheeler truck drivers? They'll tear the whole fucking trailer off.
Mm-hmm.
Not looking or taking a shortcut or thinking they know what the hell they're doing.
Yeah, one gets stuck every once in a while.
Yeah.
Every year you get a couple in the area.
You got to put your map out. You got to. I joined the RV clubs. I'm a fucking member, bro.
Do they have an RV GPS system where they're like, look, these are the roads you got to fucking use?
Yes, indeed.
No kidding.
You fucking log on to like Good Sam or RV Traveler, whatever it is, man. You'll know the exact route to go where the hell you want to go. You fuck up when you start taking little side roads and shit like that. No, I know, here's another thing you fuck up. You fuck up trying to drop somebody ass off. You know, you drop their ass off 4 blocks from their goddamn house. Don't fuck your RV up driving down their neighborhood. Don't stupid ass goddamn trees hanging down and shit. You'll fuck your RV up. You drop their ass off
on the side of the highway.
2 or 3 blocks. Yeah, you drop them off at the gas station near their house somewhere. Have someone pick them up from there. I'm not going by your block and fuck my RV up.
Here's your guardrail. I'm leaving it right here.
That ain't happening. You got to get off right here.
Did you check out the $1.5 million RV just for shits and giggles? I want to see what that looks like.
Oh, my God. No.
No.
I am not playing. 2 bathrooms. Full fucking master bedroom with a bathroom in the washer, dryer, marble floors, lighted ceilings, cameras outside. Someone ring the doorbells. Fucking, no, you name it, it has it. I promise. Sound system like you would not believe. Big ass fucking flat screen TVs everywhere. Four pop outs. The shit goes from like a regular size. Once the pop outs, the slide outs open up. You are in a fucking apartment that makes a New York apartment look dumb.
Can you sleep in the pop out and sit in the pop? I always think they look like they're too weak to hold the weight, but they're not.
No, that's how they're made, man. They're on tracks. The whole thing pops out, opens up. The whole shit opens up, man. I promise you. Look at that. Look at the fucking gauges and shit. Instrumentation. Fucking kidding me, man? Alarm systems. Any fucking thing. Someone outside walking by. You are too close. You are too close. You know, it's like, what the fuck? Oh, good. good. You feel safe in that motherfucker.
You're in trouble. You're going to buy one of these eventually. Man. You know you're going to have to.
I put some James Bond shit on mine. I put smoke screens and shit. You won't be following me home, motherfucker. The smoke screen on your ass.
Wow, look at
lasers
this.
And shit in front of it.
It seems like cool a lot of bands, instead of renting out the tour bus, are doing RVs now.
They it's, live it's cheaper. They pull up somewhere.
To do the RV thing.
It's cheaper. They stay in these bad boys. Yeah. It's custom. All
that's nice.
Sometimes it takes months to build. If you have one built, it'll take like 6 months to build it. Because you have everything you want in there is in your RV. I promise you, man. And you know what, man? I'm telling you, man.
You ever take it on tour,
you motherfuckers are
JV?
Single. You motherfuckers are single. You would pick a lady up in a goddamn RV?
You think? Yeah.
It's a long way from the old dude in the fucking van. Remember that dude? The fucking dude. You got a customized van and shit.
Yeah.
Nah. This is next level right here. TV's outside. Bar. Bar system outside. Outside. Look at this shit. That whole shit, that's classy shit. Look, the grill slides the fuck
slides
out.
Slides right out.
You grill.
You don't have to set
tailgate.
Up your grill.
You know the, you a fucking tailgate?
Yeah, I love tailgating.
Shit. I tailgate anywhere, man. A fucking parking lot. I tailgate in a fucking supermarket. I'm going to fuck. I love tailgating. I tailgate in a fucking bar mitzvah, a baby shower. I pull that motherfucker up. People get mad at me. Here he go with that fucking RV again. I bring the RV to a goddamn baby shower. I'm going to fuck. I'll park that shit right in front of your house.
Now, have you done a tour with this, JB? Doing like stand-up dates? Driving around the RV or no?
Yeah. I'm
that's how you travel pretty much with it?
Hey, I'm going to the big game, you know, Super Bowl. I'm thinking about driving my goddamn RV down there just to tailgate and still stay in the hotel. Just because.
You can.
Just because I can. I show the fuck up, man. You show up somewhere in your RV, people will come. I promise you. It's like a fucking mountain, man. You know, or a building. You build it, they shall come. Right. You park that shit somewhere, people going to want to come in and have a good time. All you got to do is put a little sign on the door. Do not shit in my goddamn bathroom. And life is good, I promise you.
That is, it looks like it's a lot of fun, man. It looks, I'm also fascinated with tractor trailers. Like, I look at the ones with the sleepers and the giant ones, and I want to be in one of those. So, it's not like an RV, but they seem like such a fun little thing to be in.
You want to be in a brand new one that's yours.
Yeah.
You don't want to be in one with no stinking ass goddamn truck driver driving in it.
Yeah.
You don't want to hit your ride with this motherfucker. He's talking filthy motherfuckers. No, you don't want to play with that. But I promise you, man, that's life.
Nice.
You know, here's how I feel about everything, man. Mm. We are all alike. We all have the same body parts. We have the same blood. But sometimes you got to do some white people shit once in a while. Black people don't be afraid to do some black people shit once in a while.
What are black people shit that white people should do?
Yeah, give us one thing we should do.
Some suggestion. Black people shit.
Give us one thing we should do right today.
Cool. Okay,
today,
like right now.
Yeah,
you guys as white guys should go somewhere. Right, get out of this. Like, expand your closet. Like really go somewhere and say, should I be buying these fucking pants and this fucking cool hat, or should I pay my motherfucking rent? Like, you should really consider that one day. Like, shit.
I thought we were going to just start by saying the N-word.
No. That's too typical.
I went to a concert last night and I got like the brand new Anthrax shirt, the new tour shirt.
Nice.
And I thought that was good.
Good for you.
Not good, JB.
No. Typical shit that you always fucking. But if I went and bought one of those motherfuckers and rocked it, that's a whole different category.
Yeah. Are you saying we should actually at one time consider, do I get the hat or do I pay the rent? That should be a consideration.
You should live like you know goddamn well you shouldn't have done that shit.
But us, us white boys cannot wear that hat.
No, you can't wear that shit.
That hat would just not
work. It doesn't
look
right on me. I don't have a good face for hats.
It wouldn't work.
A lot of people do not have the face for this fucking hat. This hat, it's like certain styles, certain looks. Like, let me tell you. Even myself.
Yeah.
I'm from North Carolina, right? Been in New York all my life. But I consider myself very European. So this tight-ass goddamn sweater I got on right now,
yes.
This sweater tight as fuck right now. I can feel my arms tingling because the fucking sweater's so goddamn tight. But this is how they do it over in Europe.
Sure.
My ass, I've been to Europe a few times, a handful of times. Yeah. I can't speak that shit. I don't know French. I don't know French. I don't know none of that bullshit. But I carry myself every day as if I'm European. My pants are tight as fuck. My sweater's nice and tight. You know what I mean? All I know is wee wee. That's all the fuck I know. The scarf is very European. This shit is European shit. The average person wears their scarf hanging down. I wrap my shit around my neck and tuck it inside.
You can't pull off the scarf
either. You can't pull this shit off, man.
We can't pull that look.
That's what
that
I mean.
Off.
You got to take yourself. Sometimes you got to put yourself in other places sometimes just to have, just give your life. Just live your life, brother.
All right.
And the scarf is very nice.
No humdrum.
It's a beautiful scarf, but we could not pull that off.
Nice shoes.
You can't pull, I'm going to be honest, you can't pull none of this shit. You can't pull a goddamn thing I got going on right now.
JB, look at every guy in the room. None of us can pull it off.
Anybody? All you can pull off right now is my goddamn underwear right now. That's all I got a chance to pull off right now is my goddamn drawers. That's it, man.
Listen, we have to take a break, unfortunately. We got Jay Williams coming in. Can you stay, JB?
What time is it, first of all?
It's 10 o'clock.
10 o'clock.
We got a half hour.
Is there a place I can shit in here?
Yes, there is.
Well, let's shit. Well, let's just shit. We got Jay Williams, man. He's coming in.
Bring Jay up in here, man. Bring Jay up in here.
Yeah, he's going to be in about 5 minutes. But I hope you stay. If you don't, four courses with JB Smoove on MSG Network is a great show.
It's a great show,
it's
man.
It's a great show.
And JB is at Caroline's. Tomorrow through Saturday.
Oh,
no
kidding. Oh, man, I'm going to be talking some shit.
Really brilliant comedian.
Two shows tomorrow, two shows Friday, two shows Saturday, man. Always fun, man. Great. You know what I mean, man? There's no plan when I go on stage, man. I feel like you just be as comfortable as we are right now.
Mm-hmm. I remember seeing JB doing, he was doing comedy like 6 months, and he was doing like 45 minutes and killing. And I'm like, you gotta be fucking kidding me.
No, I'm a milker. I fucking milk the fuck out of shit.
No kidding. We just talked about RVs for 45 minutes.
It was amazing.
You know what, man? I feel,
and he made it hilarious.
I feel like, here's what I'm going to do. Yeah. I'm going to throw something to the universe. You do what the fuck you want to do.
Yeah.
Anytime you guys are in Los Angeles, California, I will personally pick your ass up from the airport in my goddamn RV. We'll go straight to the beach. We'll grill. We'll stop by a little food market, get some fucking food, and we will eat and shit together. How about that, brother?
All right. Listen, we do have to take
Absolutely.
A break. JB might be here. I hope he is. If not, it's Caroline's tomorrow through Saturday. And then, of course, on the MSG Network.
Four Courses
is just a great show if you haven't checked it out yet.
Oh, snap, JB Smoove on Twitter.
Right. Oh, snap, JB Smoove on Twitter, Instagram, and jbsmoove.com, the website. I'm on everything, man. I'm straight up.
All right.
Social media dude, bro.
We got Jay Williams.
I'm on all RV sites and everything.
Yeah.
Old snap, jbsmooverv.com. I don't give a fuck. I'm all over the place.
All right. We got Jay Williams next. Stay there.
Yes, sir.
Oh, yeah. JB Smoove said, fuck it. I'm sticking around. This guy's a busy man, and he's sticking around. I like that.
Sticking around.
I like when that shit happens. Hey, Caroline's tomorrow through Saturday.
Tomorrow through Saturday, man. It's going to be fun, you know. Caroline's is always a great spot for me. I always have a great crowd coming out, so I'm looking forward to having some fun.
You don't need to take it easy on me. I'm a grown man.
Wow, what happened?
Grown-ass man. Bro, man, you good?
What's up, man?
Hello. Hey, Jay. You're well-dressed, man. This man right here is well-dressed. Come on, man.
What's up, Jay?
What's up, man?
Pleasure to meet you, Jay Williams.
You too, man.
What's going on,
good?
Buddy? All right.
Good, man.
You look good, too, man.
What's he yelling at?
I'm trying to come in with my Barack Obama face on.
Oh, man.
I'm
just soft as hell, man.
Get out of here.
I'm just telling these guys, man. Look how fucking good this dude look, man.
Boy, we look like dorks now.
Yeah.
I'm trying to tell you guys. You
two well-dressed men in this studio.
I said, look.
The white guys really look like shit
Holy
in the studio.
I'm trying to tell you guys.
Things are changing. Thank you.
I'm trying to tell these guys, man. I get them a tongue lashing a little earlier. Get your shit together.
When I saw Opie this morning, the first thing I said, I said, "Do we get the shirt at the same place?"
Opie's very fashionable, though. He does it.
Can you get me a coat?
It's like the Lower East Side apparel. You know what I mean? That's how I look at it. I like that.
Don't do it all at one time. Just pieces. Don't overwhelm yourself. Don't overwhelm yourself. Just get a shirt one day. Do it gradual.
I got shitty barrels on for the winter.
You know how guys say that they put that Grecian formula in their hair?
Yeah.
They were completely gray, and a little at a time, it started turning black, and no one noticed.
All right.
You put a nice pair. Right. Put some clean-ass socks on one day. Clean socks one day. You know what I mean?
Your peace outfit together.
Nice pair of pants one day. You know, we get compliments here and there.
Look, we're all like doing this.
Nice shirt.
We're trying to cover up now.
That's what I mean.
I've never seen you guys this quiet before, by the way. Jim, I've never seen this quiet before.
No, I'm observing. I'm trying to think about it. Yeah,
making good sense right now.
Fan of your show, listen to it.
You'd listen.
Yeah. Is that okay?
That's awesome.
Why are you saying that he doesn't? Why are you thinking he doesn't?
Is that a shock to you guys, really?
Yes, we have very low self-esteem.
Yeah, yeah, we do.
Hey, man. I mean, your story is unbelievable, Jay Williams.
It's intriguing.
Yeah.
I was a little bit late. I just got, you know, it was a little bit of traffic out there, so I just got off my bike.
We haven't gotten the book until we literally got it this morning. Rolling the six, so I have not read the book, but
the story itself is unbelievable, and I think it helps a lot of people out that you could like turn things around.
Well, a lot of ad work before the picture, though. I'll tell you that, JB, you can appreciate that.
That's an amazing shot of Jay Williams. And just basketball shorts, well, not basketball shorts, but shorts, and shows the scar on your left leg.
Yeah, you know, the Cliff Note version is that, look, you know, we all yearn to be successful, right? And obviously I'm at the table with a lot of people who are successful, and you work, you keep your head down to get to a certain level, and then it gets to a certain point where, you know, can success go to your head? And for me at the age of 21, I never dealt with success before, right? I never dealt with fame or getting attention or hanging out with guys like this on a regular basis, right? So, you know, you get lost in that. It's easy to get lost in that. And plus, look, I came from Camelot. I came from Duke, right?
Yeah.
I lost 13 games in my first 3 years of college.
Yeah.
I lost 13 games in my first month in the league.
Yeah.
Right? So when guys don't care, when guys are smoking weed, doing drugs throughout the season, when guys are kicking it to girls, you know, why? I kind of felt I got lost in the season as well, where I didn't care. I started getting planes and going to Vegas and partying and doing stupid stuff and became part of the problem. And then that problem culminated with hitting a utility pole going 70 miles per hour because of my ego. And that's when that led me to get addicted to Oxycontin and, you know, try to find myself after years and years of pain.
I remember when it first happened, people were really hoping that you would be able to come back from that. But
they weren't the only one. I was hoping too.
I know.
Right.
And then, well, that was what was so depressing, because you had a hell of a career ahead of you.
Well, you know, look, there's certain, people ask me all the time, like, oh, would Derrick Rose be there? And I would say, look, I know my confidence level. I feel like if I didn't get hurt, I don't know if Derrick Rose would be in Chicago. I know Kirk Heinrich wouldn't have got drafted with the 7th pick while I was in the hospital bed.
Right.
So those are little things that obviously always make you think, what if? But at the same time, man, I truly feel that things happen for a reason. And I know that's a cliche, but I firmly believe that. And it's like the path I was going down seemed so damn destructive, right? I wonder if I would have been just like everybody else, somebody been lost in the darkness, you know?
Or paralyzed. Like, you hit something like that, and the fact that you're not dead or you're not paralyzed below the neck is like, okay, that it sucks to
it's
lose.
Like a sign.
Or a major head injury.
You're alive.
So much more could have happened.
Yeah.
So,
I mean, I split my pubic symphysis by like 13 inches, by the way.
Wow.
So that's wider. So my pelvis right here, like literally, like where your penis is, got split 13 inches. So it's wider than a woman having a baby. Like, so for me, like, the most humbling thing out of everything, basketball, right?
Right.
Like, was the fact, like, when I couldn't get an erection for a year plus.
I've had that happen for other reasons.
Yeah.
Well, they do make medication for that, I found out.
I just get nervous, Jay.
Performance anxiety, that's what we call it.
So, is that where you hit the pole?
Well, the bike was, literally, I was on my bike, kind of, you know, coasting away from my agent who was watching in the doorway. And for some reason, man, apparently, you know, having a billboard in I-90 wasn't enough for my ego. So I had a new exhaust, no helmet on, no protective wear.
Yeah.
And I wanted to show off. So I revved my engine once and it vroom, loud. The second time, louder than the first. In the middle of the third, the rev just out here, click, click, it just slipped. And the bike slipped gears and it went to second. I popped the wheelie. And I wish I would have let go of the bike. But, you know, anything, 21 years old, right? I just bought this new bike, right? I'm confident in myself. I want to control my destiny. You know, so I grabbed onto the bike, which pulled back the throttle even more. And next thing I know, the back wheel spun off to the side, and I was headed towards the utility pole. And I tried to turn it at the last second and just clipped the whole left side of my body. So it's like, you know, imagine that. Like, just full force, one part of your body is going with the momentum, whereas the second part of your body is being held back by it.
Yeah.
And, man, next thing I know, I'm on the ground, chest is up on the pavement as if I'm laying on my stomach. My navel is pressed up against the curb, and my legs are up on the grassy knoll area like I'm laying on my side. So my body was just twisted like a pretzel. And I was bleeding internally. But crazy thing, I didn't yell out, I don't want to die. I yelled out, I threw it all away. Because I knew at that moment, I just fucked it up.
I was going to ask you that.
I knew it.
I was going to ask you that. When you're in that state and you're laying on the ground and you know what just happened, what's the process in your mind? Are you thinking are you thinking that far ahead? Like, oh, shit, I just fucked up everything? Or are you thinking like, okay, you know, this is just a hurdle. This is just a bump in the road. I'm going to be good. You know, I'm going to get back to training. I'm going to do this. Da, da, da. I'll be all right. Or you thinking like, shit, I know this could be.
Well, you know, the thing is, when it first happened, it was like, well, have you ever been in shock, right? Have you ever been in a car accident? So it's like one of those things that happens in slow-mo where you see it about to happen. You're like, oh, shit, is this really happening?
Yeah.
Right? And it's like when I was on the ground, it wasn't one of those things where I thought about, oh, I'll be okay. It was like I felt somebody pouring hot, scalding water all over the lower part of my body, mm-hmm. right? But when you try to, first off, when I was touching my legs, Jay, like I couldn't feel my damn legs. I couldn't feel myself touching my legs. Like, that's freaky.
Yeah.
Right? And then you look at your hands and you're looking for blood, right? Because you feel the sensation of you bleeding and you don't see no blood. So it's like, what the hell is going on? Like, I'm bleeding from somewhere.
Oh, you feel yourself bleeding.
Oh, yeah. I feel like somebody's pouring hot, scalding water all over the lower part of my body.
Shit.
So it's like that moment, not even thinking about dying, I was like, damn, man, I worked 21 years to become the second pick by the draft. I just had Jordan's locker. I was doing things that I dreamed of. I was taking my mom on vacations. I was able to build a business with my dad. My dad worked multiple jobs his whole life to get there. And I just threw this shit away for riding a damn motorcycle.
Now, do you think about also, I mean, I know I think about other responsibilities. Do you think about yourself immediately, or mm-hmm. do you immediately think about all the responsibilities and the people who are actually relying on you?
Exactly.
You know, I think about that all the time. Like, damn, if I stop doing, like, it's a different thing. But like, let's think about if you stop doing what you're doing right now,
your family,
all your responsibilities. Do you think about your responsibilities, or do you think about, damn, I fucked up, or do you also go into that thing of, wow, what am I going to do about my mom? What am I going to do about my kid? You have to go through that process while you're laying there. And I know this is totally different, but you're at a big show. Shit ain't going right.
It's never happened to me, but I've heard.
Do you have that?
No. He's never had a big show either.
Yeah, because he's got performance anxiety. That's why.
I've had people say they have an out-of-body experience where they can see themselves mm-hmm. laying there, and they're actually watching themselves lay there. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that has anything about to do with like the mind, or are you physically like, you know, to the point where you hurt so bad that you see yourself.
What was it? What was your first thought?
Yeah.
Well, I think it was a series of thoughts, right? Like the first thought was, what the hell did I just do to myself? And then as you settle into that thought, you're like, what the hell did I do to the bigger picture, right? Like, my mom had just met Arne Duncan, right? Like, when we were talking about doing bigger things in the school system, who would have known he would have, you know, been Barack Obama's secondhand guy, right? Like, my dad and I were forming a business. We were about to expand in that category. So like you start thinking about all the people that you just let down. Until, you know, and this is what I'm thinking as I'm in the ambulance, right? Like, I can't believe I just let all these people down like that off some dumbass decision to be brash and to be a young, egotistical young man.
Were you married or have kids at that point? Or no.
Oh, okay, no. That's good. And I still don't. I'm still, but I'm with somebody now. But it was one of those things where it's just like, yeah, I just threw everything away. And then when I got to the hospital, that's when shit started to really hit me because, you know, when you think, look, I've been a boy before. I've done stupid things, right? Broken some bones. You break a bone, you go in to see a doctor. The doctor looks at it. Oh, you broke the bone. They put it back in place. You get a cast.
You know you're going to be all right.
And I saw like 15 people running around me, like in a scurry.
Oh,
and like
fuck.
Her name, Dr. Mal, was like, hey, I need your parents' number because we need permission to do surgery because you're bleeding internally. Ooh. And that's when it hit you. Like, oh, shit, I don't want to fucking die.
How close were you to death?
Well, I mean, I was close because I severed an artery in my left leg.
Oh.
So when you look at my left leg, you know, they didn't know if they're going to be able to keep my leg. I have four slits, about probably like 10 inches apiece on the inside of my left leg. And I also have that slit. You see it on the picture. I'm 150 staples on the outside of my leg because they had to relieve the pressure.
Right.
So I had a graft in my leg where they had to, you know, take a vein and flip it around to use it as an artery. I dislocated my knee. So imagine taking a chicken wing and just snapping it in half and letting it dangle. That's what my knee looked like. And I severed my peroneal nerve, which allows you to pull your foot up and down. So it was like one of those things, man, like where I woke up the next day. It was like, you ever have those dreams, yo? Like where you're sleeping at night and you have a really messed up dream and you're like, holy shit. And you wake up and you're like, thank God.
That you're was relieved.
A dream.
Yeah,
thank
yeah.
God that
yeah,
was a yeah, dream. Yeah. I can't, that was crazy. That yeah. can't really happen. I woke up, I was like, this has to be a dream, right?
Yeah.
Like this can't be real. Like I can't be seeing three metal pins inserted into my leg.
holding my leg up in the air. I can't see two metal pins inserted into my pelvis, connecting my pelvis and keeping it together.
Wow.
Like, this can't be real.
And you said it took you a year to get an erection because it fucked up the area. So at least your dick is, everything remained intact. Like, so it could have been worse. I mean, you know, trying to find a bright spot to it, you know?
Yeah, it could have been worse. You know, it's funny though, too, now, because now, look, I'm self-deprecating. You know, you move through things in life. But my friends for that year and a half, 2 years, I would wake up in the middle of the day because I was always high on Oxycontin and stuff. And I would wake up and there'd be like porn playing on my TV. And my friends were like, come on, let's get it back. Let's get it back. Get in the game. I'm like, I can't. I got nothing.
Yeah, well, plus they're nothing. Plus, they're in the room. You're exactly. Like, yeah, get out of the room.
Get out of the room. You know? Yeah. Performance wow. anxiety once again.
Yeah. Now, Jay, most people, I mean, let's be honest, most people would have given up.
But I tried twice, man.
You did?
I tried twice. Wow. The first couple of weeks after my accident, you know, look, I weigh 200 pounds. After, you know, my accident kind of calmed down, I weighed about $1.55, $1.60. And I was just so out of it. I tried to take scissors across my wrist. That didn't really work. And then the second time was like the worst. You know, it was when I stopped playing basketball. I was trying to figure out who the hell I wanted to be without the sport. I worked for an agency. We just got done recruiting Kevin Love. Kevin Love had said some pretty hurtful things to me in the media. And I was like, fuck this, man. Like, it just sent me into a deeper spiral. And I was living on the Lower East Side. That goes to show you where I came from. Like, I went from having an apartment downtown Chicago. I was like 10,000 square feet to living in the Lower East Side with three of my friends who were bartenders. And it was like a dungeon, right? At 25 years old.
Holy
like
fuck.
Plates and literally you had to go inside this building, outside, downstairs, this rail. And I had a drug dealer. I was literally this like kid who was a teenager who had like different, all these different crazy backpacks and would like hand me Oxycontin. I would pay him cash for it. And I was just drinking a lot, lost, man. And I got really hammered one night. And the crazy thing about my accident is that I still have people to this day that will come up to me and be like, yo, I'm so sorry. Or, yo, why'd you throw it all away? Or, you're that guy that got in that wreck, right? So that will break me down even more. So I got hammered one night, you know, fell down the stairs on my way to my apartment, got in my apartment, took like 3-4 Oxycontin, drank a half a bottle of Jack, and was like, fuck it. Like, I hope it stops. And I woke up the next day, and it was like, damn, I'm still here. Like, I must be here for a purpose. I must have a reason to be here. And that's when I was like, screw it. I just went cold turkey. I quit Oxycontin. I stayed in my room for a couple of weeks, sweated it out, had hallucinations, and started to try to pick my life back up, man.
And you haven't had anything since?
Excuse me?
You've been off it since?
Yeah, I haven't been on it since I've been like 25 years old.
Wow.
26 years old.
So, wow. What clicked in your head that made it turn around besides that bottom, obviously? Was there something else?
It was weird, man. It was just one of those things where, you know, I tell people all the time, who's on your board, right? Like, you look at boards of companies, the CEO has to answer to somebody, right? And this group of people, this round table, they brainstorm on how to make the company better. So why would you look at yourself any way differently, right? Like, everybody's their own company. So I asked me, like, who's on your board? And I was lucky enough to have people on my board who was like, yo, I refuse to let you quit. Like, I refuse to let you lose. And I started doing things like, oh, we're going to have a weekly meeting about, talk to me about my pros, talk to me about my cons. Like, tell me, I had people like, they were real with me. Like, yo, you flake. You disappear. Yo, you lie. Yo, you cheat on your girl all the time. You're crazy. You're sleeping with random people. What are you doing? Like, you're spending your money. Like, I'm going to start holding you to a higher standard. And those kind of conversations made me start to hold myself to a higher standard. And it's like one of those things, you start to slowly pick up the pieces. Look, everybody's had an accident, man. Like, you know, shit, my accident is no different than, I don't know what JB went through in his life, right. But I'm not going to lessen what he went through because for him, it may be on the same scale.
Pretty much. Yeah. He doesn't want people shitting in his RV.
Yeah. That's what it comes down to.
That's JB's really move right there.
It's my issue, though. It's fucking my issue.
I know it's your issue. It's just as.
That's big. Did they use the toilet paper on the toilet, though, to keep it? Or did he just plop right down on it?
You don't invite everybody in your RV. That's the problem.
Jay, they're saying you got to go. Yeah. I could talk to you for an hour. Why do you got to go already?
It's probably TV, I'm guessing, or something.
Let me ask you. I know you're on ESPN, but what else are you doing with your life?
The book is great. It's a platform. I'm dying to be a host one day. Like, I watch this dude on TV, and I do random crazy stuff, too. I'll talk to anybody. I don't care. Random conversations.
Love it, man.
Find some way to, like, I see what Strahan's able to do. I'm
like, okay, like, cool. Like, I don't know what it is. It's the athlete in me, but you always have to find somebody you have to chase a little bit, right? Like, when I was a player, like, okay, like Jason Kidd, like, I want to be that. Like, I look at Strahan, okay, like, I want to be that. Mm-hmm. So my thing is, this is the start to that for me. Okay, find a bigger purpose, man.
Good for you.
Yeah. The book is called Life is Not an Accident. Are there any signings? I don't know if you have anybody with you. We have a list of any signings. I think so.
I did one last night in Jersey. I'm going to Chicago. I'm doing stuff in North Carolina. Wow. We're trying to arrange one here in New York. I'm trying to arrange one in JB's RV. So I can take a shit in his RV. Book, hopefully he'll let me.
It's called Real J Williams on Twitter, and realjwilliams.com is the website. So hopefully you can get any signings there in your city, because it looks fascinating. I'm really annoyed that we didn't get
it's
this
It's a
before.
Hell of a story.
Thanks, man.
How you turn things around is just amazing.
Well, I'll come back, man. I'll see you guys.
Please do.
Continue to listen to the show, man.
That would be, you're an inspiration.
He's a Jersey boy, too.
Right down the street.
Really?
I love it, man.
If he's got to go, we might as well just shut down the show. We're good. Fuck it. Jay Williams, thank you so
Thanks,
much.
Thanks, Wiz. I appreciate it, man.
JB Smooth.
Caroline's tomorrow through Saturday. Myself in Louisville, Kentucky next week. And then Jim?
Yeah, I'm Valentine's Day weekend, Laughing Comedy Club, Fort Myers, Florida. And then February 18th through 21, Improv, Cleveland, Ohio. Chad Zumach, Joe Howard on the show.
And I'm going shopping. For a new shirt.
I'm not.
Today, 3 o'clock, my advice show. So tune in.
Yes, very good.
Bye, guys.
Is that it? I guess that's it. They're exchanging numbers. We're going to go. We'll see you guys tomorrow. This was an awesome show. Florentine, thank you. I had a blast today. See you guys.